bought a one-way ticket, brought my saxophone and a bag and sent it. That was the most terrifying decision I've ever made in my life. And like learning how to surf and then getting into free diving and dedicating time to learning how to slide bait, catch ulua's. Like I was just eager to learn all these different things, but the water was always something that drew me close.
And was that part of your family culture or is that just you?
That was just me.
Interesting. Where'd you get that interest from?
I think, I mean, I don't know. I'm a Pisces.
still, I just started learning Japanese.
Oh, 日本語喋る. これは水じゃない. これお茶. Shaka Hawaii tea desu. Guava ginger.
Okay. I said I just started like a couple of days ago. Delina Maikako, welcome to Keep It Aloha, a podcast that keeps aloha by reading bass and bass and not knowing which one is which if you don't have any context because the English language can be so ridiculous sometimes. I'm your host Kamaka and today we're going to be talking to bass fisherman. This is so confusing. Let's move on. Before we introduce our guests, I want to give a shout out to Kama Moiha, Adrian Kaonohi Okala, Kaivi Connor, and Kalei Maiole, aka Happles, on our Patreon, for signing up for the $10 Kako'o tier on Patreon. These people get an uncut episode every week before the episode is released to the public and many more awesome benefits. Check out our Patreon at patreon.com/kamakadias if you want to join and be a supporter just like them. But if supporting us with money is not for you and you still love this podcast, please consider leaving us a review on Spotify or Apple Podcasts. It helps out so much with the algorithm and helps us get bigger opportunities in the future. You can also head to keepitaloha.com to get some awesome KIA merch just like I'm wearing right now and hanging up in the background. Okay, let's introduce our guests. Some coaches are doing more than taking on opposing teams. They're also taking on cancer, and you can help them. Texaco in Hawaii and Coca-Cola Hawaii are teaming up to raise funds for Coaches vs. Cancer, benefiting the Hope Lodge, which provides free accommodation and support for cancer patients and caregivers in Honolulu. Buy any 28-ounce Powerade, 20 or 32-ounce vitamin water, or 700-milliliter smart water, and Texaco in Hawaii and Coca-Cola Hawaii will donate $1 from each purchase to Hope Lodge in Hawaii, up to $10,000 combined. Or make a cash donation of your choice at the pump or inside at the register. Join the team supporting Coaches vs. Cancer at Texaco. Immerse yourself in the underwater wonders of Hawaii's marine life with Hawaii Ocean Charter's hands-on guided snorkeling tours. Whether it's your first time falling in love with Waikiki or you're rediscovering its beauty just like me, there is no better way to see it than from the ocean. Personally, it was one of the best things I have done this year. I got to snorkel with some turtles and fishes, and I was able to catch the coolest sunset over the water. Conveniently located in Kaka'ako with online booking and live availability, finding the perfect day on the water couldn't be easier with them. Ride in style on their unique and well-cared-for power catamaran that offers all the amenities you need. Locally owned and operated, their friendly crew lives for sharing their love for the ocean with others. Sunset cruises, guided snorkeling tours, whale and dolphin watching, coastal sightseeing, and fireworks shows are among the tours their guests love the most. Use code KIA50 to get $50 off of your next charter. Our guest today is a professional fisherman from the island of Oahu. He is the first person from Hawaii to ever fish on the Elite Series and qualify for the Bassmaster Classic. This 2021 Bass National Champion, former actor and musician, was also one of the OG content creators in Hawaii going back to the Vine days. Throwback. Outside of bass fishing, some of his hobbies include surfing, spearfishing, and playing the saxophone. I am so stoked he is here today because he is the sexiest fisherman in town. His name is Matty Wong. Aloha, Matty. Welcome to the Keep It Aloha podcast. How are you doing?
Oh, I'm good, man. Thank you for having me.
No problem.
That was a pretty awesome intro.
Thank you. You did a lot of awesome things. Honestly, my brain was using so much brain power trying to read bass and not say bass. That was the hardest part of the intro.
Yeah. It's classic. I have my, one of my good friends is a bassist and I have a shirt that says Aloha Bass. He's like, oh bro, it's Aloha Bass. So I could be whatever you want. So,
yeah, I guess without context, you don't know what it is.
You don't know.
Yeah, that's English. I know. All right. Well, we're talking a lot of stories before this podcast started.
Yeah.
So I'm happy that it's recording now.
We're rolling.
We'll get this out to the audience. So let's just start at the beginning and then I know we're going to be talking forever. Because yeah. I know you're not Hawaiian by blood.
Yeah.
But you got to have some Portuguese in you.
I'm not Portuguese.
Oh.
I'm not Portuguese.
Why you talk so much then?
Just get plenty for Taco Bell,
okay,
bro.
Yeah.
No, not Portuguese. Fifth generation local Chinese.
Wow.
So I tell people like, oh, you're not Hawaiian. I'm like, no, but you like to eat rice, right? Oh, you're welcome. But no, my Chinese side goes back to Kauai,
mm-hmm.
on like some of the early rice plantations over there. And then half Haole. So
got him, Hapa. Hapa boy. Well, all right. Well, let's get to know you. We always start at the beginning. Where are you from? Where are you grad? And what was it like growing up?
Yeah. Well, I went to Kalani High School.
Falcons.
That was an interesting time, you know. I grew up in Pololo and always been a lover of the water and consider myself a waterman and love music, love it all. Just very blessed to grow up here, you know. It's like different times though,
mm-hmm.
even though it's only been not that much time has passed, but a lot has changed.
Yeah.
And but yeah, it's a trip.
Well, you're probably only a couple years older than me, though. What year are you grad, if you want to share?
06.
Okay, well, I'm 11.
Okay. Yeah,
so kind of in that same area. I could have been a freshman when you were a senior. So that's how I kind of consider close-ish.
Yeah,
depends if you're late born or early born.
I was like 18 when I was graduating.
Yeah. Okay, so yeah, still kind of, we grew up in the same time where we grew up without social media. We grew up with social media.
Exactly.
Probably Saturday morning cartoons, unless you was probably Saturday morning Hanapa'a.
Yeah, watching Mike Sakamoto.
Yeah, that's probably you.
Yeah.
Okay, and I I'm from Hilo, but I graduated from Kaiser.
Oh.
Yeah, so we're rivals.
Yeah. Okay, well, see you guys.
All right, podcast is fine. Next.
No, it was funny because there's… I'd surf a little bit in high school and we would always just try to beat Kaiser. But I mean, they also had some hammers over there. So it was hard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be real. The private schools got us.
Yeah.
When it comes to sports, we're just trying to hang around.
I tell people Kalani is like the private school reject school.
And then Kaiser is like the nicest public school.
It's the
like
nicest the private, public school for Waimanalo.
Yeah, exactly. South Nalo. We don't say Hawai'i Kai. Yeah, we say South Nalo to see more.
Where are you from? Oh, bro. South Nalo.
Yeah, South Nalo.
Oh, Rod. Where's that? Oh, you know.
you know, right under Kamiluiki Valley. Yeah. South Nalo. Right under Kalama Valley.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh, bro.
So you went to Kalani. You just grew up outdoors.
Yeah.
Just surfing, fishing, all that.
Yeah. You know, ever since I was a little kid, my dad used to take me just with bamboo pole and go catch tilapia and stuff like that. And I was eaten up by fishing because of that experience with him. And then through with my friends and stuff, like learning how to surf and then getting into free diving and dedicating time to learning how to slide bait, catch ulua's. Like I was just eager to learn all these different things. But the water was always something that drew me close.
And was that part of your family culture or is that just you?
That was just me.
Interesting. Where'd you get that interest from?
I think, I mean, I don't know. I'm a Pisces.
Should we pull up our co-stars? Yeah. You have that app? See if we're compatible.
My moon rising is…
I just figured this out. So I'm an Aries. Yeah. I think my moon is a Gemini and my rising is a Virgo.
Yeah, no, I didn't read that far into it.
I just learned that recently.
It's a trip though. I don't know. It's water's always drawn me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, growing up in Pololo, there was Waimau, the stream, and I would always listen to the stream and it would always like relax me. And it was always something that was so soothing. And then when I would go boogie boarding at Walls was like the Waikiki wall rat. Mm. And then learning from just a bunch of different mentors throughout my life on like stuff that I was just interested in, whether it was spearfishing or fishing or surfing. And I've been someone who's just always chased passion.
Mm-hmm.
And I think
not the comedian, right?
Not the comedian.
Okay.
Yeah. Shout out to Passion.
Yeah, one of the Viners. Yeah. I remember I seen a video of you getting chased by some Canucks.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh.
You know what I'm trying to talk about?
Yeah. So that was on the set of that film that I was talking about earlier.
Oh, no way. Yeah. Nice.
So that one worked out. I was like, okay, boys, we got to do something. Everyone's in Malos.
Yeah, that's a classic one. If you go, just look it up, I think. Because I tried to look up your old Vines, but I couldn't find many. Yeah. And one of the videos I saw was, it's him saying like, oh, I think I grabbed the wrong slipper. Yeah. And then he's on the beach running and there's like 20 guys in Malos and spears just chasing after him. It's so classic.
That was good. Yeah, when you grab the wrong slippers at the house party.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
Yeah, so we'll get into all of that because I'm really interested in that part of your life, because we were on the phone the other day. I have a pre-production call with all my guests, little BTS. And he's telling me that he used to do Vines, and I was like, that's why he looks so familiar, because his whole profile is just like fishing.
Yeah, playing fish pics.
Yeah. So I always thought, because when you reached out to me over a year ago, I was like, this guy looks familiar, but I don't know where.
No.
Because I watched Vine all the time. Yeah. It was like my college days, I think.
Yeah.
And then you told me that and it just clicked like that. Yeah. So funny. But anyways, how does music play a part in all of this? How did you get involved with music? Because I feel like you were spearfishing, surfing, whatever. And then saxophone is just so random.
Yeah. No, it was funny because, growing up in a musical household, my dad is a member of the Sounds of Aloha, which is a barbershop chorus that we have here in Hawai'i.
And, I didn't know. That's still a thing there.
Still a thing that's going on. And they're trying to do, community outreach with youth and stuff like that. But ever since I was a little kid, I would sing with them. I sang with them until I was like 8 or 9 years old. But that's where the initial, the feeling that you get when you have harmonies and everything that just comes together with music, there's no other feeling like it. It does something that's like, it's almost spiritual, and so that was always a connection. And then the next thing was, okay, are you going to either take a language in school or are you going to take music? And I'm like, well, I like play music. So that's why I started going towards that direction. And then I couldn't pass the rhythm test in elementary, where we were picking different instruments. And they're like, okay, you can either play the saxophone or the trumpet. And I'm like, all right. Hey, mom, what's your favorite instrument? And she's like, the saxophone. And I'm like, okay, well, I'll play the sax. Yeah. And so I played saxophone through school. And then, and just kept with it. It was something that I enjoyed playing. And then I ended up having like a fun career as I was going through college with it. Being able to do, whether it was studio recordings or play shows or whatnot, it was just, I don't know, always enjoyed doing it. And it was something random. There wasn't too many saxophonists at the time that were playing out. Mm-hmm. And now it's become more of, it's cool seeing other wind instruments popping up and stuff like that. It's like a resurgence of something,
Yeah, it's a weird trend in life how these things are really popular, then they die off, and then they come back.
Yeah.
Fashion.
Mm. Oh, like my gosh, trends right now.
Fanny packs, certain haircuts.
Yeah.
Even like dance moves or whatever. Yeah. It just comes back and everybody's all into it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everything ebbs and flows.
Yeah. So what's interesting about you to me is you're kind of like a jack of all trades.
Mm.
And kind of like how I want to be is kind of just very well-rounded, but also have these just random skills that nobody knows about. Because the more I learn about you, I'm like, wait, you do this and you do this and you do this. And that's how I like to be as well.
I mean,
right?
you are that.
Well, I mean,
you're crushing it, bro.
Still, I just started learning Japanese.
Oh, 日本語喋る.
Okay. Mizu desu. Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
これは水じゃない。これお茶。
お茶や。
シャカのハワイティーです。
シャカティーです。
ゴアバジンジャー。
Okay. I said I just started like a couple of days ago.
Well, 頑張って。
Yeah. That sounded really cool.
Oh, cool.
But yeah, that's all I know. I'm learning objects and food right now.
Well, good luck with objects because it's a trip. There's a counter for everything. Long cylindrical object, there's a different counter than paper from a drink, from animals. But if you stick with like iko, niko, sanko, it's easier.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, whatever Duolingo, I just want to get a real basic understanding because we hear a lot of Japanese words just growing up in Hawaii. I know like watashi no namae wa Kamaka.
Yeah.
I think that's like all I know and just like hayaku and...
Yeah.
Baka,
it's baktare, the like words that we speak in pidgin, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And then you're like, wait, what is that? Mm-hmm. Is that even a thing? And then you're like, oh, okay, that's where it comes from.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's why, you know, you were talking about language. I want to learn Olelo Hawaii super bad. And it's something that I've always like, it's been this orb of power that I'm like, oh, I would love to just feel it, you know? Because it's just, I feel like it's such a cool part, even though I'm not Hawaiian. No more koko, but I get the hot, you know? And I think to be able to speak more about the land and about our culture here, right? I think that's the only way to be able to truly understand it.
For sure.
And to share it. But
where did that Japanese come from? I'm still figuring it out.
2年勉強しました。カピューラに短期大学です。But chou wasureta. So I studied for a couple of years, Kapi'olani Community College, and then I also at UH, and then I forgot a lot of it. But enough. It's interesting because in Spanish, right, you can study Spanish for 4 years and be pretty proficient. Japanese, you can study for 4 years and it's like taking 1 year of Spanish because of the alphabet and everything that you got to learn. I'm actually going to Japan and. 2 weeks.
Okay. Yeah. So you're brushing up on it. I mean, you sound good.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah. I get the accent.
Yeah. You're good at mimicking. I remember another video where you pretend to be like a Chinese takeout.
Yeah, we're freshed out a cat. Sorry. No.
See, this guy.
Nah. I miss it.
Talent.
It's funny because like the golden years of comedy or local comedy, people are like, oh, wait, oh, I don't like to say that now. Or, you know, it's like, a Chinese, let me go.
Yeah. So here's the thing.
Yeah.
I'm just going to be super blunt. People are soft. This generation is soft.
Yep.
That's the reality of it. Our local culture, teasing each other was part of it.
Part of it.
You could say it's like racist jokes, but I think it's just racial jokes.
Yeah. Not racist.
And, especially... If you're Japanese, you're making a Japanese joke. If you're Chinese, making a Chinese joke. To me, it's like, okay, you kind of have like a little pass to do that.
Oh, for sure.
But also, it's all lighthearted stuff.
We don't mean it with this like, this vengeance of, oh, brah, all Portuguese talk forever.
Yeah, and we know it's just a stereotype.
It's like, of course Portuguese talk forever.
Like, I mean, we're all Asian here. There's so many Asian. We're just like, we always just make an excuse or joke like, oh, I'm bad at math. I'm like, but I'm Asian or whatever it is. Yeah. Or like, sorry, I'm not good at math even though I'm Asian, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And people just can't take that seriously.
No.
They just can't.
Yeah, no, everyone's soft.
It's not your responsibility to be offended by everything for everyone.
Yeah.
That's the thing. People just find reasons to be offended. And that's the reality of it.
I miss the old days.
Yeah, it was good. I mean, now you can just get canceled for everything. That's what we're going to do. We're going to throw this last couple minutes up on the trailer.
Yeah.
And nobody's going to watch this episode. They're just going to in the comments like, cancel Matty Wong, cancel Matty Wong. Wow, he's so racist.
So racist. The guy's middle name's Chin Ying, but he can't do a Chinese joke. Bruh.
Yeah, no, that's crazy. It's a little side tangent, but
I'm
happy we agree on that. And it's just an opinion.
Yeah.
Which is factual.
Yeah. It's classic because I remember like in elementary, Frank DeLima would come and
Yeah.
And he would be like, his whole skit was just all race jokes. Mm-hmm. And he's like, nah, it's okay at all because I Chinese, I Filipino, I Portuguese, and Japanese. So I can make fun of everybody. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, and he would always say, no, it's as long as you are that race, you can make fun. And everyone was like, okay, so that's the rules of comedy. Shoot. Mm-hmm. And then everything started, like, people started getting uber sensitive. But I think, you know, the thing is special though, Hawaii hasn't changed that much mm-hmm. when it comes to that stuff. It's nice to be able to come home and then drop a Portuguese joke or go drop a popolo joke, mm-hmm. you know, or like whatever. But it's like, okay.
I think the only thing that has changed is the environment in which you can use those jokes now.
Yeah.
So you can't use it as publicly around people you don't know. But when you're in an environment like close friends or people that you know aren't going to get offended, then you can really just let it rip.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it's true. You got to be more cautious where you say those jokes. But for the most part, if you grew up in Hawaii, you're not going to get offended. So
yeah.
I don't know.
If you went true local.
Yeah. If you went true local, bro. Not the kind get the calabash, Maika E rewards card or whatever.
The Mahalo Rewards card. Right on. Well, that was a fun side note. But we'll get back to your school. So you graduated from Kalani and then you ended up going to college for a couple of years.
Yeah.
But then you stopped, right?
Yeah. So went to Kalani. I did the extended program at Kapi'olani Community College, which is just like taking a couple classes a semester, but I was playing music at the time. So I was in no rush, you know, as long as I was going to school. And then, went to UH and then got into the ACM program, and it was still in its infancy. I think it was our second year as the program was around, or third year. And then went there for a year and a half and then ended up dropping out and then moving to LA.
Yeah. And then for those who don't know, I think ACM is Academy of Creative Media.
Yeah. Sorry. Okay. Academy for Creative Media. Which now where they're at is incredible.
Yeah. They've done such a good job.
Yeah. Shout out to Chris Lee and like everyone.
I just met Chris Lee at the HIF Awards.
I call him my Uncle Chris. Yeah, he's hi nephew. My
yeah. He's doing Chris. A good job. He has that program in many different places I hear.
Yeah. So it's really cool when it comes to, you know, just being able to create the atmosphere for one creative media and then teach people industry foundation or standards, I should say, and then getting them more prepped up to go and work on sets or whatever else that you want to do, content create. Mm-hmm. But at the time, it wasn't that. They were still trying to figure out what was, you know, what was the best curriculum or how should they teach certain things. So it was kind of strange.
Yeah. So let me get this right. So you were probably surfing by morning, creating content by noon, and then playing saxophone by night. Was that kind of like a day in the life of Matty Wong?
Yeah. I mean, I've always enjoyed creating. Mm-hmm. I think it's an outlet of our heart, right? It's just getting stuff out there. And it's tough for some creators because you're always afraid of like what people are going to think or whatever. But it's for me, as long as I can get it out there and create, and I knew that there was going to be some people that would enjoy it. Mm-hmm. But more so, as long as I can make myself laugh or I enjoyed what I just created, that's good.
Yeah.
And so that's what I would do. I would go to school and then create whatever whatever I felt like creating. And then, play music at night. Mm-hmm. And it was wild. I miss those days.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a lot simpler. You didn't have to really worry about rent and car payment and All right. So why did you decide to drop out and not pursue ACM anymore?
So it was an Indigenous filmmaking and aesthetics class. And I remember the professor was handing out the syllabus. And there was a couple of films on the syllabus and she was saying like, okay, this semester we're going to study, a series of films that some local filmmakers made. And they, you know, made sure to get cultural advisors. They made sure to do the right steps to make these films. And I'm looking at the syllabus and I recognize one of the films. It's like Until the Sun Sets. I'm like, miss. She's like, yes. And I'm like, that's my film. And it was a film that me and my friends, we called ourselves the Rising Suns, because two of them grew up Japan, Hapa, or all Hapa, and then the other one, Ryan Miyamoto, who grew up here. And we just make these films for Showdown in Chinatown. And I remember we made this film, and it was the challenge of the competition was you had to use the Pacific Ocean as a prop. You had to use Hawaiian, and then that was it. And so we made a pre-contact Hawaiian, then the whole thing was olalo, and it was like this love story. And we had a bunch of people help out on it. The Keolanas helped out on it. It was a really cool community project in a way, because everyone just kind of came out of the woodworks and just wanted to help. And so it was funny because I was thinking to myself, I'm like, wait, why am I going to school right now? Why am I paying to go to school to learn something that we've already done outside? I'm like, you know what? Okay. I need to see if I can just, I want to take a break. Not to say that I don't ever want to go back to school, but I'm like, I want to take a break. And I talked to my dad about it, and I was like, Pops, what do you think if I move to California? And my dad, local Chinese, you know, I thought he was going to be like, no way, boy, you know, finish college, you know. And he's like, go. I enjoyed it. I lived in California for a bit. I was like, wait, what? Really? He's like, yeah, go. And my popo had passed, you know. And so she was like a really important part in our family. And it was a pretty tough time. And so it was kind of interesting to get my dad's support there, because it was something I didn't think I was going to get. And he's like, yeah, go. So I was like, okay. Mm-hmm. So in 2012, I saved up as much money as I could. I was working Hans Hiedemann, surf school. I was parking cars at Morton's. I was playing music 5-6 nights a week. And then I was like basically done with ACM at that point, and just trying to save up money just to move to LA. Bought a little car, bought a one-way ticket, brought my saxophone and a bag and sent it. One-way ticket, bro. That was the most terrifying decision I've ever made in my life, because I was leaving behind my support group, my family, my friends, something that meant so much to me, like growing up here. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to challenge myself. Yeah. I didn't want to turn 25 still living at home, you know, and still like not feeling that challenged, having everything, you know, like being able to go surf when I want, go play music with incredible musicians. And I wanted to feel the struggle.
Yeah.
You know, like I wanted a challenge, and that was, oh, brah.
Yeah. Well, I can imagine. I mean, first, I commend you for that, because you did something that not a lot of people would do, is you left your comfort zone.
Yeah.
And that's so scary to some people, but that's the only way you're going to grow, is by putting yourself in hard situations and uncomfortable situations and getting comfortable being uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Which is why I joined the Peace Corps, which you told me that your girlfriend was in the Peace Corps too, which is a super cool thing.
Yeah.
But really, it's being away from the comfort of your own home and the comfort of your own known environment.
Yeah.
That's what helps you grow and helps you see life differently.
I couldn't agree anymore, man.
So awesome. You got to LA. Did you know anyone?
No, I knew one person.
You knew one person. Yeah. And then like tell us like what happened.
Bro. So it was random. I was just trying to figure out. I'm like, well, I have some money that I saved up, right? But I'm like, what am I going to do? So I'm going to start hustling auditions and maybe play music. And so I got some gigs. I'd play music with my friend Joni, who's a local musician who moved out there. We'd play on the promenade. We went and played in Hollywood at like the Hard Rock Cafe and all this stuff. And it was like, okay, we're going to split a gig for $70. You're like, $70? It's like, you guys are charging us for parking. I'm like, how can you survive doing that? Mm-hmm. So then the music, I you know, I played some fun shows, like, you know, and got to meet some good people. And so I started, it wasn't as the same. It wasn't like it was here when I was playing with the Deadbeats and Lost at Sea, like my friends, that we had this incredible musical community where everyone always come out and show support and aloha. And it was something that I was like, oh, that's what made it so special. And then when I was doing it in LA, you're surrounded by a room, everyone's has her arms crossed and they're just looking at you and they're just like, that's it. Mm. You're like, bro, like, get into it, bro. We're playing music. Enjoy, yeah. You know, smile.
They're just trying to judge you.
Yeah, and, judge, yeah. You know, just the piercing eyes of judgment. Mm. And you're like, what's this environment? Like, what is this? It was the first time I'd ever experienced anything like that. Because again, in Hawaii, something special. We all show aloha. We're always making sure. Oh, bro, that song was sick. Mm-hmm. Yeah, your voice cracked, smoke kind, but hey, it was mean. You know, you still went up and you tried. There, oh, you're just slightly out of tune. Oh, this guy's done. Mm. You know, it was this really strange environment. And so it kind of like a little bit turned me off from playing as much as I'd like to play. And then hustling auditions at the same time. I was like going out for commercial stuff. I was going out for TV shows. Like I got arrested on this show called Perception. I play an Asian gangster and I mug some guy back when I had long hair. Mm-hmm. Put it up in a ponytail. It's pretty classic. And then I realized I'm like, oh, I'm always going to be that typecast. Like I don't want to be that typecast. And around the same time, I had a friend who came out to Hawaii, was in a really tough time in his life, and it basically saved him. He went on to telling me that he was thinking about killing himself. And until he had an experience where he visited on Maui, and this random group of local people came and was like, hey, you want to come eat with us? Come. And invited him to come eat like at a cookout.
Wow.
And he's like, I've never experienced such a random act of just such a warm welcoming and kindness. And he's so instantly he was drawn towards me because he's like, oh, you're from Oahu. I'm like, yeah, man. Like, how's it? And he's like, I love Hawaii.
You're my best friend.
Yeah. And I'm like, okay. You know, but like,
what are you doing tomorrow? Yeah. At 3 o'clock.
Yeah.
I'll pick you up.
Yeah. And so, no, I started surfing with him and everything. And so he was part of the photo industry. Mm-hmm. And he's like, brah, hey, I know you're working at the surf shop right now. So I was at the surf shop. I was like surf coaching celebrities. Like it was like this weird, just trying to make ends meet. I was like anything I can just get done just to pay the rent. And he's like, hey, you want to be my fourth assistant and come, you know, come work on a photo set? I'm like, sure. Like that. And when he offered to pay me, I was like, but I have to work a whole week at the surf shop to make that. So yeah, I'm in. And so that was the start for me in the photo industry. So I'd taken, for the first time in my life, I'd taken a step back from being in front of the camera to doing now behind the scenes and making other people look beautiful and making other things like come together and orchestrated. And so it was like this huge, it was a shift for me, right? Because like you're saying, like the Vine thing, you know, playing music. I used to do like all the voices for Taco Bell and Pizza Hut on radio. Like I was, you know, in my head, I was like, smokin', high mox, you know? I'm like,
oh. I made it.
Yeah, like I made it, bro.
6 seconds of fame. Yeah.
Like, I'm like, I'm Santa Jr. You don't know that voice? Like, so stupid. But it's like, I needed the experience of LA to crush me in a way, you know, to be able to demolish an ego down to rubble. And then to do the opposite of now, away from the front of the camera, away from being an entertainer, and then now how to work and collaborate with other creatives, how to become more of a team player and be able to create something special. And so then from there, I worked my way up from a fourth to a third, worked my way a third, second to a first. And then when I was working as a first, I started shooting my own stuff, worked as a lighting director for a couple motion shoots. And that was an incredible 8 years of my life. I blink and 8 years went by having this business. And it was pretty lucrative. I got to travel all over the place and I had fun doing it. It was a new environment all the time. But while I was in California, there was also fishing, but there wasn't traditional fishing. There was bass. And I remember like growing up in Hawaii, growing up going to Lake Wilson and catching bass with my dad. And that's something that I've always loved to do. I've always something that's always intrigued me. And so I would go slowly start going. There's like these urban ponds in LA, like Echo Park. This is a place called Kenneth Hahn. Like literally these little isolated Aloha's, super pilau, but there's fish inside. And I would just go just cast just because it was therapeutic. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where things slowly started to change, where I started realizing, oh, wow, you can compete doing this stuff. well, that's kind of fun. Oh, whatever. So I started, I tried. And after putting in a couple years of learning all the ropes and whatnot, I'm like, okay, I'm going to compete. So I started competing. And within the first year, I gave myself enough confidence. I'm like, oh, well, okay, you're good enough to compete now. And so why don't you actually try a full season of the amateurs, which was the Bass Nation in California. And so my first year as a, they classify you as a boater or a non-boater because you have someone riding in the back of the boat. I was my first year as a boater. I was off this 1990 old Ranger with not a lot of electronics on it. The thing was pretty bus, only one working gas tank, you know, like full on Pololo boy making, making work of whatever, you know, had. Yeah. And so I started, I did that season and I almost won the first event. I ended up qualifying for the regionals, which was something that I never would have thought I would be able to do. And I make it to regionals and this is 2020. So this is like right around COVID and everything's going crazy and whatnot. And the regionals were in Havasu in Arizona. And I led day one and I ended up finishing third overall. And then that qualified me for the national championship, which was in Louisiana on the Ouachita River. And that was the best boater and non-boater from each state all came together for this national championship where the winner gets a ride on the Elite Pro Tour, which is the highest level of competitive bass fishing. You get a boat to use for the year and then like 20 grand.
Wow.
So it was a pipe dream for me to even make it all the way to the nationals. And I ended up winning the whole thing.
And that was your first season?
That was my first season.
So rookie of the year.
Like, well, because I started competing in 2018, but I was doing local events. Mm-hmm. So there's smaller events per region. And then in 2020, I signed up for this, the Bass Nation, like amateur series, if you will. And then, yeah, ended up making it to the whole thing, which blows my mind because there's so many people that I met along the way. They're like, bro, this is my 30th year fishing this. And I've just made it to the regionals or I just made it to the nationals. I'm like, wow. Okay. Well, I'm grateful, but yeah. Wow. And so and right there, it changed my life because I wasn't sure where I was going in LA. Yeah, working in the photo industry was great. I was getting paid well. I was spending plenty of money living in Los Angeles. I didn't feel whole. There was something, a part of me that was missing. I'm like, there was something started to eat away at me where now I'm letting other people dictate, you know, what I should be creating, because it's like, okay, we have, this is the artist, this is the references that we want it to look like, and then this is, we need you to make it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, okay, but what if that artist is like really not a good person? What if they're not standing up for the right things, or what if they're just like, just not good people? But okay, here you go. We're going to pay you to make them look good.
It sounds like you're doing something that was so unnatural and not intrinsic to who you are as a person, even though you're doing it to make ends meet.
Yeah.
And I'm not even talking about just like the physical act of photography or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's being around people in that environment where it just wasn't Aloha.
Yeah.
Or it just wasn't Pono.
Yeah.
Like what you grew up with. So you were just missing. It's like, I think people feel this when they go away. It's they're around people that aren't like their friends and they start comparing and like, you know, comparison is a thief of joy. So it kind of just sucks you. You're around people that just don't give in or don't put good energy into your life. And it just sucks and draining the positivity from you. And although, you know, you got to make ends meet, it's just like, you have that feeling where you're just like, I need to do more.
Not sugoi desu.
But no, I know I've been in situations like that. Like, and it's when I leave and I leave and I go to beautiful places and have beautiful experiences. But there's some times or I'm put in certain environments where I'm just like, I just want to be around the people at home or just my people or mm-hmm. people like me
that understand me.
Yeah, and not even look like me.
No,
representation is great. And like yeah. when you see a guy from Hawaii or a yeah. girl from Hawaii, you know, it's brother, sister. Yeah. But it's just people that are like minded, mm-hmm. and that's the biggest thing. Mm-hmm. So. Mm-hmm.
Agreed, man.
Yeah, I'm happy that you found your passion. You almost, when we talked about it before in the podcast, yeah. is like when you get older and you being your true authentic self is really just going back to the child.
Yeah.
Because what did you love as a child?
Fishing.
Exactly. And now you're doing that as from a passion yeah. to a career.
A career now.
And you're whole.
Yeah.
You feel happy.
I do.
And that's awesome. And I'm getting chicken skin.
Oh, bro, you gave me chicken skin too.
Because
bro.
I love that. I love when people yeah. succeed. I love when people yeah. succeed in the things that they love to do.
Yeah, it's crazy.
It's like there's no greater feeling to be able to do what you love.
100%.
And make a living off of it.
100%.
And I hope everybody experiences that at some point.
There's something that's so rich in that, right? It's follow your heart, follow what you love to do that makes you feel whole on every level, and the money will come. Mm-hmm. I think when people start chasing the money goes faster.
Yeah.
When you start chasing what your heart wants and what you feel whole as, the money will come mm-hmm. unexpectedly.
Yes. Like, I didn't expect to be making money doing a freaking podcast.
And look at you now.
I know. Hey. But the thing about I want to say about that is like, sometimes we have to do things mm-hmm. that we don't like to figure out what we like. So, it's not always just chasing money because, yeah, like the dollar signs, you're like, oh, cool. Let
no,
me
but there's a term that I like to use when I was working in the photo industry. It's called golden handcuffs because you're locked in. I don't care. Yeah, pay me. That's fine. Well, you ain't paid plenty. Oh, that's, yeah, I'll keep doing that. But then the longer you stay locked up this way, your heart and everything else is getting drained. And so I think it's important to recognize that when you're in a situation like that. And how are you going to make a change? How are you going to pivot? Take what you learned and then move it to something that's more rewarding for you. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's a tough lesson, bro. Because some people just get locked in and then they become blind. And then they try to project, you know, other stuff that, you know, that their own insecurities.
Definitely.
Because and that's where they're like, oh, bro, that guy, he don't talk too good. I mean, his stuff kind of interesting, but, you know.
Kind of funny. I chuckled once or twice.
Yeah, once or twice, but, you know, I don't know about that guy. But those are the people that are like, you know, because they're too afraid to go out and do their own thing. They're too afraid to go out and just put it out there.
Yes. You know, the people who are never laughing at you, degrading you, talking down to you or judging you is the people higher than you. Hmm. It's the people who have success. It's always the people at the bottom who are like judging you, looking up.
Yeah. It's interesting. It's, I don't know. It's a crazy world we live in, bro.
Yeah. And especially when this goes for social media too, is the people who aren't doing anything with their lives commenting all the bad things.
Oh yeah.
On
those
social
are the
media.
Trolls, bro. They're like in their mom's basement.
If you're doing something of value, you don't have time to be on social media just hating on people.
No. That's why I just like, bro. Like the Drake meme, the haters.
Yeah, yeah, it's like, just put on that Aloha armor.
Yep.
Pew, 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 pew.
Serious.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's life's too short to listen to that stuff.
Yeah. That's I love it. So you won the 2021 Bass Championship. Mm-hmm. Is it B.A.S.S. on purpose? Is that an acronym?
It's an acronym.
Okay.
So it's the Bass Anglers Sportsman's Society.
Okay, so they just wanted to make it more confusing for everybody.
Basically, essentially.
Basically.
Base.
Basically.
Basically. Or should I say basically?
But
it's a trip.
So you won. That just changed your life.
Yeah, it changed my life. Right there, I realized, okay. You know, it's funny because like when I talked to my brother right after I won, and that was a really emotional call because he's like, bro, look, everything that you always wanted and now it's here. And then I talked to my girlfriend and they had offered me the spot on the stage. They're like, are you going to fish the elites? And I said, you bet your butt I am. And I didn't fully digest what that meant. And I remember she's just like, well, you don't have to make any decisions right away. I'm like, no, I'm going. Like, I need to. This is an opportunity. This is a once in a lifetime opportunity that I'm so lucky and grateful that I got. And I don't ever want to live with regret. I don't ever want to like grow old and look back and be like, I wish I took that chance and just went, even though it's the thought of it was terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
And so as soon as I won, I'm like, okay, I got to go to work now. I didn't pick up a rod for 2 months. I sat at my computer and I just made phone call, email, try to just, it was a culmination. I feel like all from my life experience all coming together, where it was the people in my circles, where it was, whether it was through the surfing industry or through the music industry or through the photo industry, everyone just came out of the woodworks wanting to help me. Hmm. And it was so humbling, because I'm like, bruh, like it was like this overwhelming feeling of aloha from everyone, that they're like, bruh, yeah, I want to help. And because in that moment I realized, okay, I need to get rid of everything that I own. I had an apartment, I had like I had my own couches, I have my I have my tackle wall, I like everything set up the way I want. Like, finally, like I had the space that was mine. But to go and chase this dream, I had to now just get rid of everything. And I had a financial advisor that was a part of the fishing club that I was with, and he's like, okay, bro, make everything liquid. He's like, sell everything you can. Anything that means anything to you, ship it back home. So I did. I packed up all the things that are super special to me, sent them back, or in Pololo, still in the box. And I just basically tried to save as much money as I could. And I closed down my photo business in LA. Had to say, so long to a lot of long-term clients that I had. And closed my chapter in Los Angeles. And that was such a rewarding time, man, because it was talk about a place where it was just different, just so different from what we're used to. And but I was also filled with gratitude for what it taught me,
mm-hmm.
and what I needed to learn at that point. Mm-hmm. And so, boom, was able to take that with my new marketing understanding, the new photo understanding, and all this other stuff. And I put together a pretty sweet little pitch deck, man, and was able to fund that first year on tour. And when you win the national championship, they give you 2 years. And so I was just so grateful to align with so many good companies that I never would have thought in a million years that I would be partnered with.
Mm-hmm.
And it all came into fruition. I'm like, I literally have to pinch myself all the time, bro. I'm like, I can't believe this.
That's amazing.
It's a trip.
I really believe that life gives you what you need, not what you want. And I think, it goes along the lines of like everything happens for a reason.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know a lot of times people don't see it in the moment.
Oh yeah.
But once like the chapter closes or another opportunity comes, it makes you realize like, oh, I needed that in life.
Yep.
Or that was supposed to happen so I could be here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything going back to like your childhood, to, when you were in school, when you had an interaction with somebody,
mm-hmm.
I truly believe as I get older, like that's all meant to be. When yep. people ask like, if you could go back and change anything,
no.
would you? I never want to, even though say I wanted to play sports in college, whatever, but I had too many injuries and, but that led me to all these other things in life. Yeah. So it's like, if I change one thing, like maybe I wouldn't be here.
You wouldn't be the same Kamala.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And even like the bad things, like if you could get rid of the bad things. No, I love the bad things in life.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't love it in the moment.
No.
But
the lessons you learn from it, and then the other things that come out from it. I mean, like, because I feel like the hardest times will sprout, whether it's creativity or it will sprout a new part of your life.
Mm-hmm.
And it's extremely hard to see when you're in it. Obviously.
Definitely.
It's blinding, like pain, suffering, anger, depression, everything is just like a cloak, but it's hard to see that there's a window with the light coming through. And that's the positivity that you just like keep reaching towards. And when you hit it, you're like, whew, you look back, you're like, okay, now I know that this is meant to be, or mm-hmm. this, I needed to go through that to arrive here.
For sure.
Yeah.
You know how I know what aloha is? Because I know what aloha isn't.
Yeah.
I know how to be positive because I've seen so many negative things in life.
Yeah.
And I basically, it's the same way as we mimic the good.
Yeah.
We don't mimic the bad.
Yeah.
So it's like, I've been in times in my life where I felt like I didn't keep it aloha, or I just didn't have aloha given to me.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I don't ever want to do that. So I'm always going to
shackle back on the H1.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Exactly. I get so upset when somebody goes in front of me and they don't throw up the shaka.
Yeah,
they
know shaka. Yeah.
Or you learn. When I do that, I always shaka because I have to hold myself accountable because I want to be the aloha I wish to see in the world.
100%.
So that's why don't stray away from the bad and the tough, the struggles in life, because that's going to teach you what not to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. Same with failure. You know? Yeah.
Oh, just like what you said. Mm-hmm. I mean, earlier, it's we learn in the times that we're uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
It's true, and sometimes that the times that you're uncomfortable is when you're going through the hardest moments of your life,
mm-hmm.
and you're like, okay, how am I gonna learn from here? And then life gives you a way, like, okay, now there's your path, or there's a way, there's a door. The door just opened. Now you got to step through it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what he's talking about. Yeah, we get deep and we're only going to get deeper. But what he is talking about being uncomfortable is holding in your shishi after drinking a lot of shaka tea.
Okay, shishi break.
So we'll go take a shishi break because getting a little uncomfortable here. We'll be right back.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, we're back from a quick shishi break. Mahalo to our drink sponsor, shaka tea.
Mahalo for the shishi.
Oh, I don't even know where I put mine.
The shaka.
Oh, I left it. Jordan, do you mind grabbing it?
Guava ginger.
Yeah. Okay, I'll do that again. And we'll keep rolling. We'll keep rolling. It's fine. Yeah, I just forgot my shaka tea. Here we go. Thanks, Jordan. Videographer, producer, and assistant sometimes.
Yeah. PA.
PA, everything. Yeah. All right. So we'll get into the social media fan questions presented by Texaco in Hawaii. All right. So the first one comes from the Native Hawaiian Trading. And yes, I feel like you know this person because I feel like this is an inside question.
Okay.
Ask him what tastes better. Bass or slipper lobster sashimi?
Oh, this guy. But a pili.
Okay.
Aloha, guys. How are you? Obviously, his slipper lobsters.
Okay.
So
explain.
But a pili is an incredible fisherman and runs his own family-run production of straight from the ocean straight to the table. So, yeah. Huge shout out to him. Talk about a hustler, bro. Putting in the hours. And his Instagram where people can... And it's cool because he sells dried aku and all kinds of stuff on the side of the road.
Located here on Oahu?
On Oahu.
Oh, nice. Yeah. You got to check him out.
Yeah, got to check him out. It's... He gets slipper lobster.
Wait, what is slipper lobster?
Wait, what?
I don't know.
Bro.
Context here. I'm a land baby. I played sports, land sports all my life. Nobody in my family fishes, surfs, nothing. I only started surfing like a year and a half ago.
Okay.
So no, I've probably been fishing like once or twice in my life.
Well, we got to change that.
Yes, yes, please. I would love to learn.
Bruh, I'm serious.
It's something that I wanted to do. I'm getting more into the water in my adulthood.
Yeah. You know, okay.
With surfing and everything.
Well, if it's not this trip, next time,
yes,
you can definitely come out of my boat.
Yeah.
And we're going to put some fish in the cooler.
Yeah. I like Hanapa. I like post some of my story.
You like flex on
girls.
Yeah. Flex on the fish. Yeah.
Just let me hold yours.
Oh, okay. No, but his Instagram is the Native Hawaiian Trading.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So check him out.
Yeah. Okay. Check out Bada Pili.
Nice.
Yeah, you okay, silly guy. Yeah, I don't eat bass sashimi, guys. You sucker. But yeah, slipper lobster. I forgot the Hawaiian word, but they're incredibly delicious. They're super special too. I believe they're endemic to Hawaii as well.
So it's not a joke. It's an actual real thing.
Yeah, it's an actual.
I thought he was just making like
it's a size 10 olukai with the. No, but
not an ad.
No, not an ad. Plug. There's a
sponsor.
Yeah. No, they already do.
Oh, okay. Perfect.
Yeah, mahalo olukai for all
your
support.
They're supposed to send me something. They had like this campaign they DM'd me about.
Okay, well, I mean,
so is that you're just gonna give me yours, or
I'll give you mine? Honestly, I'll give you the slippers straight off my feet, bro.
I'm a size 10. Local slippers for life.
And we gotta change that.
That's too small for me. I go oversized. I go like 3 inches bigger.
Oh, you
I'm
like
a size 10? That's a 13 or 14.
Oh, that's the kind after burns when you put it in your hand. You know?
I like a lot of flip to my flop. Exactly, because when you put them on the hand, it goes a little
full
further.
Forearm protection. Yes. No, for sure. I'm gonna change that. I'm gonna give you a pair of old guys.
All right.
What was I saying? Oh yeah. So there's the Hawaiian spiny lobster, and then there's the slipper lobster.
Okay.
And they're super super tasty.
Okay.
Especially if you sashimi them when they're fresh.
I have to try it. One thing that I learned about lobsters recently, because I did with sauna and cold plunge, and in the sauna I just talk with random people.
Yeah,
this guy works on a boat, and I think he's from California.
Okay,
Trevor, shout out to you. He was telling me how lobster, so it's like a delicacy now. It's like a very like fancy thing.
Yeah,
you get at,
but it wasn't before.
But it wasn't.
Yeah, yeah.
It was poor people food.
Yeah,
it was so abundant that they would just give it to
in
anybody.
Maine, it was just like dog food. Yeah,
that's crazy.
And so they had to The importance of marketing and narrative. Through marketing, they changed the stigma of lobsters.
Mm.
And then turned it… They used to feed it to prisoners.
Yes.
It was prison food.
Yeah, that's crazy, right?
Nuts. It was like, oh, okay. Bring it here.
Yeah. Like, oh, lobster, here, take it away.
Yeah, lobster.
Give it to this peasant.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
I'll take the potato.
Yeah. lobsters are… Yeah, they're crazy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Cool. Cool side note.
But yeah.
All right. Next question comes from AZ_Bass_Slayer. How was bass fishing on the island growing up?
Special.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think anywhere that you can… I mean, again, it's an invasive species. But what isn't now?
Hey, but that's why you catch them. So
to eat them sashimi style. Yeah, yeah, yeah. it was interesting because on Oahu and on Kauai, the only other place besides Florida that has peacock bass. So we have this unique species of, it's actually a cichlid, but they're extremely fun to catch because they fight super well. They're acrobatic. They jump all over the place. I call them freshwater papillos, and they're beautiful. And then there also we have largemouth bass and smallmouth bass, but it was different. You know, it's not like you have all the fancy. It's not like you have all the fancy glitter boats like they do on the mainland, and you have all these different rigs and all these different rods for every single occasion. It was, you just go out on the lake, and just throw your little fluke or small jerk bait or whatever and target them. And so it was a lot simpler growing up. For bass, there was only a handful of techniques that I would do to target them. And it was simple. It was just a time that I spent with my dad that was really special to me. And so that's what really I cherish about growing up bass fishing in Hawaii, because it was something that I did with my family, my brother and my dad.
So, love that. Yeah. Super cool. I want to say I never hear about bass fishing here, but I'm also not really involved in the fishing community in general. So
we're going to change that.
Well, is it big though?
So this is the coolest part, right? This is the part that's so humbling to me. Since I've been on tour, I've been able to kind of turn the spotlight to highlight what we have here.
Mm.
And it's something that's unique. It's super special. And there's a group of young boys on Kauai that started the first high school bass club.
No way.
Yeah. So shout out to Cash and all the boys on Kauai. And they're doing, and I'm trying to encourage them, bro, like, chase your dreams, bro. You never know what can happen.
Definitely.
And so I've been, whatever I can do, I send them gear and I get some of my followers and they donate a lot of stuff to them, because what they're having their tournaments on stand-up paddle boards and kayaks.
Oh, gnarly.
Bro, these kids, they came up and fished a high school national championship with 377 boats or something, came in 30-something.
No way.
Bro, like, they smoked more than, like, almost the whole field. And it was their first time there.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt really special to me because I was able to help facilitate and help get them a boat to use. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, bro, of course, bro. I got to take care of the boys.
Yeah, yeah. Uncle take care.
Uncle take care. I know I'm straight uncle status now.
Oh, sixth grad right here, guys.
But
it would be funny if you were, instead of saxophone, you played bass.
Oh, gosh. Because
you went from bass player to bass fisherman.
It would just be way too confusing.
Yeah.
Yeah. It'd be too hard.
So many
way too hard.
Jokes that would be made.
Oh, boy.
All right. Well, that's super awesome. I love to hear that. Next question comes from Ava Dada. This person wants to know, how do you practice for tournaments?
Yeah. So we're given, we all have the same off limits. So there's 30 days that you cannot be on the water of the lake, just to make it even for everyone. And then you have 3 days of practice that goes on right before the tournament. And so the way that I practice is I'm basically just wanting to get a lay of the land, because most of these lakes I've never been to. And so I just want to understand, okay, where are all the creeks? Where are all the main rivers that dump in? If there's a river that dumps in, where are the creek channels? Where are the deepest parts of the lake? Where are the bass are typically going to spawn? And then you just kind of reverse engineer from there. What time of year is it? What's the water temperature? What's the forage they're feeding on? So it gets all the way down to this super like scientific study in a way. And then it's a series of elimination where you're just trying different lures and whatnot to try to figure out, okay, what are they feeding on and how are they setting up? And then once you figure that out, you can pattern. They use the word patterning, and it goes for all types of fishing. But let's say like they're eating shad, which is a small bait fish that are along the secondary or first main points on the lake. And you can run that same pattern. Oh, I'm just looking for this type of structure, and you can duplicate it all across the entire lake. And so sometimes you can figure out these kind of cool, subtle patterns within a pattern or something that no one else is doing and have it all to yourself, even though you have 100 other guys on the same lake as you. So I try to find something unique. I try to, something that's replicatable. So you want to be able to duplicate it everywhere. And replicatable, is that a word? I don't know. I'm super good at making up words. Yeah. So
don't fact check it.
Don't fact check
that's
it.
That's the number
Wikipedia.
One rule. That's the
replicatable.
That's the number one rule on the Keep It Aloha podcast. The unspoken rule that I don't think I've said is never fact check anything we say.
Oh, bro.
What's said here stays here.
It's truth.
And it's true.
It's the truth.
Every opinion is true. Every opinion that we've shared about Aloha and Hawaii and these...
It's facts.
Very, yeah.
Bugger, it's
high
facts.
Level things. It's all factual. Mm-hmm. All factual opinions.
Yep. All factual all right. opinions.
That's interesting.
Yeah. So that's how I practice.
Okay. So it doesn't come down to just the... cast them, reel them in.
So the whole thing, it's all artificial. So people think that, oh, you guys use bait? Like, no, that's the whole thing that makes it a sport, right? You're trying to trick a fish with something artificial. So it comes down to cadence, the way that you're able to like place a cast. So like there's
lures.
So lures, and there's thousands, you know, and so there's all these specific techniques, different lures that you have to present them a certain way in order to get the fish to bite. And so when people are like, oh, I mean, isn't it just all luck where you just go out and throw a worm on a bobber and just hang out? You're like, I'm like, unless you can skip that bobber underneath that dock 30 feet and then target that one piling because they're sitting on the back piling because it's being heated by the sun during this time of day and they're only feeding on crayfish that are green pumpkin colored.
You're wow.
Like, so it's like, it's
like you said, it is very technical.
It gets down to a very technical science. And that's when it kind of blows people's minds. They're like, oh, wait, so you're not all just a bunch of rednecks just going out, just going fast on the water like NASCAR. I'm like, no, there's a part of that. Bro, it's legit NASCAR on the water. My boat goes 70, almost 5 miles per hour, bro. It's nuts. Ooh. But you get to the spot because you can't catch a fish going 75 miles per hour. And then it goes and it all slows down. You have an electric trolling motor up front and you have all your electronics that kind of help you kind of dissect a certain area. There's mapping with topography maps. And then you also have different types of, the technology has kind of gotten out of hand now, but
yeah,
it's pretty wild, bro.
That's crazy.
It's super nuts.
What is that? How do you say that's crazy in Japanese?
Kurutura.
Kurutura?
Yeah, kurutura.
Yeah. Kurutura.
Yeah, kurutura.
You know, like anime, where they're like the animation changes. Sorry, I didn't just, by the way. Oh, jeez. We're getting kuruturu.
Oh, yeah, we're getting chol kuruturu.
I just have to clarify. This wasn't trying to make my eyes Asian because I just did this. I was trying to make animated.
He was trying to hide his eyebrows.
Yeah, I was trying to lift my eyebrows up because then.
A Chinese, I know more eyebrows like that.
I just had to make sure.
PA.
PA, we got PA. It quick. We thanks. Got super kuruturu.
We got chol kuruturu. Mecha kuruturu. Hi, gomenasai.
Gomenasai, gomenasai.
Yeah. It's funny. They're like, are you Nihonjin? I'm like, ah, Chukokujin. And they're like, I tell them I'm Chinese. They're like,
I love that though. Yeah. I can't wait to. I'm so excited. I've never been to Japan before.
Bro, you gotta go.
But I just got into anime. That's why I want to learn.
Dude, that's the best way to learn.
Exactly.
If I were to go back.
So I started watching and I figured if I'm going to watch, I might as well learn because I hear some of these words that we just heard.
Yeah.
And then it's just fun when I watch it and then I do like a lesson on Duolingo and then I can like, oh, you're man. Like
a, but the thing is, it's interesting because when you learn in an academic setting with Japanese, you learn the full formal…
Mm-hmm. With any language. Even Hawaiian.
Which And then when you hear conversational, you're like, bro, what?
Yeah.
What'd you even say? Nani shite no? Wait, what? Or like, oh, ima nani shimasu ka? Like, wait, what? It's like the same thing, but it's like condensed.
Well, so that's the thing where learning in an academic setting is almost broken because they don't teach conversational language.
Yeah.
They just teach like grammar so important and those stuff. But the best way to learn is to immerse yourself. We talked about it on our 100th episode. About how to learn languages.
100%. So, you know, there's no other way.
Listening to it, talking with people, living in the country.
Yeah.
Because most people talk in colloquial terms where it's just like, it's not like super formal.
Yeah.
Let's see, like it's, and we use idioms like it's raining cats and dogs. I mean, nobody really says that, but like along the terms of that,
it's raining cats and dogs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Maybe in the south,
you go down maybe to the south, Louisiana, there's some crazy stuff them boys say, bro.
But yeah, that's the thing is like you're not gonna actually learn how to speak like a native speaker if you don't learn from a native speaker or immerse yourself in certain situations. Duolingo is for me is just like a total foundational thing because I just want to learn words.
Yeah.
But eventually like…
Well, there's a whole tutor thing now online.
Oh, really?
I just got turned on to recently. And you can hire tutors. You set your budget. You set how many times you can meet with them. And it's all online. And it's an actual person.
Nice.
And then you can learn whatever. Portuguese, Japanese, Chinese.
I was just going to go to Magic Island and see… I just look for photos, the photographers. And I'm like,
just
behind it,
flashes.
There's all the Japanese
just
couples.
Just go hang out with them.
There's so many Japanese couples taking pictures at Magic Island. I don't know if you know that.
That's
I don't know if people know that.
That's the place to
there's
go.
There's so many.
It's like
every day.
It's like everyone that gets married in Japan is going to have the exact same engagement photos.
It's all diamond in the background.
With some like uncle palling out at bowls, just giving them stink eye. It's like the same thing.
You zoom in.
Yeah.
You see a finger.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
No, but yeah.
But okay, cool. Yeah, this is getting me excited for my Japanese journey. Kuruturu.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I think I could get the pronunciation down, and it's like a lot of languages where it's backwards. So
yeah,
I feel like I can learn it pretty quickly. But
that's why Japanese people can say Hawaiian words.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
All the vowels are similar.
Yeah. All right. Next question comes from Ken Miller Ka. Ken Miller, CA, like
California.
Favorite Ventura bakery in California that annual visit brings him good luck to start a season. Okay, wait, this wording is a little weird. Favorite Ventura bakery that a annual visit brings him good luck to start a season. Does that make sense?
So brother Ken is a local bait maker in Ventura. And it's not a bakery. We go to a brewery. So maybe that was a typo.
Oh, maybe it's a typo.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll meet up at the beginning of each season. And I ask him, I more so challenge him. I'm like, hey, can you make something like this? Or can you tie something like this? And he'll be like, let me see what I can do. And so every single year at the beginning of the season, he'll be like, look what I got. And we'll go and meet up and have a couple beers and show me these creations that he's made. And sometimes they don't work and then other ones work incredibly well. Mm. So thanks, Ken. Appreciate it, ba.
So what is your favorite Ventura brewery?
It's called Transmission.
Transmission.
Yeah. Right. It's cool. It was an old transmission shop.
Oh. And then they just transform.
They transform.
I love when bars do that. It's so cool.
Oh, it's neat. This one's really cool. If you're ever in Ventura, go check them out. Transmission Brewery.
All right.
Yeah. And then it's right next to Toppers. So you get pizza, super good pizza, and then you get brews.
Bias
in pizzas. Cannot go wrong.
Okay, awesome. Well, this is funny because the next person whose username is L_wall. So I'm pretty sure L, because we're thinking of alcohol. It could be Ale. I don't know. I'm sorry.
It's Ale.
Oh, dang it. See what happens when you have
too many teas.
What is not like contextual, but like where it's like relevancy, where it's like instead of saying Ale, because we're talking about alcohol, I read it as ale.
Yeah.
There has to be a word for it. Somebody can let us know.
Yeah, I'm not that smart. So.
But Ale _ wall wants to know, how has being from Hawaii shaped your career and career decisions?
That's a really good question. Mm. Hi, babe.
That's the honey girl.
That's the honey girl.
Okay, there's a follow. There's a good question after this too from the same person.
So, again, how has it shaped who I am?
So how has being from Hawaii shaped your career and career decisions?
I think it just goes back to like who we are culturally, right? I think because I grew up in a place that was so supportive of my creation, whether it was music, photography, filmmaking, and fishing in a way, you know, I had the confidence to pursue it. So I've always been someone to chase passion. Not the Vine content creator.
That's the first thing I thought about. Thanks for clarifying.
But my personal passion in life. And I feel like regardless, I feel like it's my kuleana to be a steward of Aloha. Even though I'm not Hawaiian by blood, I have incredible pride in coming from here and having the background that we do. And like, there's no other place in the world like it. So it's being able to bring Aloha to situations that are just, like you said, maybe the opposite of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that shaped my career a lot in many different ways, whether it was in the photo world and especially on the fishing side. Because most of the time people are like, wait, there's bass in Hawaii? You know? You guys get them bass? And I was like, oh, yeah. Well, actually, let me just educate you a little bit more, you know? And so then I talk about it. And I talk about, no, I didn't always just grow up freshwater fishing. I grew up saltwater fishing because I like to supply fish for my friends and family. When I come home, my neighborhood is happy.
They're like, oh, they can tell, Matt's back, Matty's back.
Oh, the little boat is out in the driveway? Okay. Yeah. So ever since I was a little kid, bro, that would bring me so much joy is bringing fish to people. Like, oh, auntie, you home? Oh, yeah, here. I get a couple minpachis for you. Mm-hmm. Or, I get one slab ono or whatever. Whatever I caught, I was able enough for our family. And then, boom, just give the rest away. So that was something that meant so much to me. And I try to do the same thing in everything I do, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just the carry the Aloha torch with you.
I love that. I mean, holding on to Aloha, having Aloha, getting Aloha is so great. But giving Aloha…
Probably no better feeling.
It's the best.
No better feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I love it. It's such a good feeling when you can just make somebody's day. You can just change their mood.
I tell people, you have no clue what a smile and a shaka can do to someone. They can be having the worst day possible and you're a complete stranger to them. And you just give them one of those. Like, whoa, what was that?
Yeah.
At first, they don't even know how, like, it like, catch them off guard.
Yeah, and especially if they're not used to receiving something like that.
Yeah, and then they're like… That was a random act of kindness
mm-hmm.
that just it affects them, whether they want it to or not. It mm-hmm. it does. I at least I like to believe that it does.
Yeah, that's why I always say, when in doubt, thumb and pinky out.
When in doubt, shock them out. Yeah, bro. That's pretty exactly. good. I like that.
All right. Well, what is your girlfriend's name?
Ale. Alexandra.
Okay.
But she goes as Ale for short. It was actually, okay. That was a nickname that they gave her when she was doing Peace Corps in Costa Rica. Was
because they couldn't say.
Like, yeah, Alexandra.
Yeah, that's what they do. Yeah, Ale.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. So the second part of this question, you've been traveling all over the mainland for the tour for the last 2 years. What are some misconceptions you had about places/things that are proven to be untrue? Which of these have surprised you in the most, and then in a good way? I can repeat it too.
Yeah.
It's been a lot.
It's a really good question. Mm-hmm. I think, when you go to the West Coast for the first time, it kind of like, it's a whole different place, whole different mm-hmm. set of cultures and a whole different set of people that you see. And so that's something that's kind of strange. You're like, oh, okay. And you get time to adapt to it and you get used to it. And you're like, okay, this is cool. What is the rest of the nation like? So in my head, I was like, okay, well, Texas, there's going to be a bunch of cowboys, you know, Louisiana, there's going to be a bunch of gator hunters, you know, and then you go like, I don't know. And then you get your rednecks, you know, but then it's funny because not until I traveled through those towns. Yes, they look at me like, what are you, some kind of Chinese boy? You know, like they're like, they don't understand. They don't know what they're looking at, but they see a smile and a shaka. So they're like, is that a gang sign? But no, I would say that I think we have a lot more similarities than we think. And this mm-hmm. is something that it took me until I was able to visit places like South Carolina, Louisiana, Texas, Alabama, where people are typically like, no, man, like that's where people are racist. Mm-hmm. I'm like, no, bro, people are racist everywhere. But there's also Aloha down there too, where it was the first time I'd experienced it outside of Hawaii where people were like, oh, y'all hungry? Come on. I'm like, okay, are we cooking ribs or whatever, you know, and then go and break bread with them. You're like, oh, okay. It's a huge family background culture where it's like they just, you know, they want to take care of the family, make sure everyone comes and eats and has a good time. And so it's been really cool for me because I've been able to break down stereotypes in my own mind. Because until I traveled to those places and actually realized it, I'm like, yeah, they talk different. Yeah, they dress different. But a lot of times they hold the same things near and dear to them and family and taking care of their good friends and people that they care about. Mm.
They just don't call it Aloha. They call it Southern hospitality.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They just don't call it Aloha. Mm-hmm. And so then I share with them what Aloha is mm-hmm. or what my feeling that Aloha is, you know? And so then they're like, oh, all right. You know?
Yeah.
And so that's been something that's been really cool and rewarding. I would say there is still a lot of gator hunters down in Louisiana. And I will say this is the funniest comparison that I had come to find out is so like you get your super brother friends, you know, the lifted truck, the chain, you know, the big visor glasses. Oh, sup Kanaka. Yep. Hawaiian. You know, you exist in the South too, but it's completely different.
It's Rangers.
It's the same thing, Bob, but it's different. It's a Ford Ranger.
Yeah.
with the window for, I forgot what.
Manual window, you know, crank window.
The crank window for crank them. But no, it's like Fords and like GNCs and stuff like mm-hmm. that. But it's the same thing. Bro, rednecks, the same thing as one woke. I never like in my million years, I would have never like drawn that to mm-hmm. comparison. They love where they're from. They love their culture and they don't want anything to come close to that. And they feel threatened if something else comes close to that or questions it. And so I was like, oh, I know exactly how to like navigate this situation. Because before I would be scared by it. You drive down in the South and you got like some dude like rocking a Confederate flag and like a shotgun in the back window. You're like, oh, bro, that guy's nuts. Same thing. You come over here, you see one Hawaiian with a Hawaiian flag and he's getting shotgun out the window. Yeah. You're like, oh,
just
brother.
Eyeing you out, yeah.
That guy's nuts. But it was trippy because it was the first time I had seen it outside of Hawaii and it actually gave me perspective because otherwise I would have just like, oh, yeah, now that's a redneck.
Mm-hmm.
But no, but I was like, oh, bro, this one mok. It's just one holy mok, bro. The same thing.
I love that. I love that perspective.
Yeah. And so because there's in both places exists ignorance,
mm-hmm.
right? It's the unwillingness to just see a different perspective, mm-hmm. or to see something slightly different. And just because they're wearing something different or dressed different doesn't mean that they're here to take your land.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's ways that people that look completely different from you to show aloha and to like actually kokua you,
mm-hmm.
or like, you know, however, there's many different forms and ways that like positive things can come from people that you would have typically never had an interaction with, or someone that you would have,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's something that's been really special for me in my travels, is that I've learned how to, one, like how to take the torch of aloha with me, but then how to receive it too from people.
I love that. Yeah. I think the only way to grow in empathy is to travel and meet other people. There's a lot of times we hate on foreigners, we hate on haoles.
Yeah.
And that comes from a place of ignorance, mm-hmm. a lot of times.
Mm-hmm.
The only way to be more empathetic is to be the haole.
Yeah.
Is to be in a place like Louisiana, or for me it was Madagascar.
Yeah.
And realize, dang, I'm the haole here.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm doing all the things that I don't like.
Yep. The things that are culturally off.
Exactly. It just gives you this crazy different perspective.
Yeah.
And then you can understand. You don't have to like it.
Mm-hmm.
You can understand where people are coming from,
mm-hmm.
when they do things that annoy you or you think are disrespectful. Because a lot of times they're not doing it to be disrespectful.
No.
They're doing it out of ignorance. Because they just don't know.
They don't know. They're not educated.
Yeah.
And you can't be upset because they're not educated,
mm-hmm.
but all you can do is educate.
Exactly. Yeah. So instead of
and
getting
then if
mad,
they do it again, them. Then you can be upset.
And then you go call up the mokes.
Then you go call up the boys.
Yeah. You're like, yeah.
Bring the guns.
The one with the red Mustang, that guy.
Yeah, that guy over there.
With the, yeah, the convertible.
Yeah.
Okay, well, great question, Ale.
Yeah.
Peace Corps volunteer, of course.
Of course.
Just the smartest people
out there.
You guys
are all literally just the most intelligent.
Well, mahalo everybody for the social media fan questions. Make sure you leave some for our next guest, and maybe your question will make it on the podcast. Oh man, that was a great section. Those are some good questions as well.
Yeah, really good questions.
Yeah. Before I ask the question that I asked all my guests, I just want to ask you, what are your thoughts on the Peace Corps? Because I don't really get to talk about it as in conversate with people.
Yeah.
I share it. Uh-huh. Like, oh, the Peace Corps is this and this, because not a lot of people know about it. But since you're dating somebody that's actually been in the Peace Corps, you have a different perspective of it.
Yeah. I wish I knew about it. I don't think the government now pushes it at all, or at least the way that I think the general public can even see that it's still an existing.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was telling my dad about it, and my dad's like, oh yeah, it used to... That was like a big thing they used to push in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah.
And then now it's just kind of like it's fallen into the shadows. But after learning about it through Ollie, I was like, wait, what the Peace Corps? What is that? That sounds like some hippie stuff. What's going on? You know?
I did have long hair. And didn't shower every day.
Yeah. It's okay. I'm not gonna judge you. But it's cool, man. Talk about community outreach. Talk about helping people learning. An excuse to go to another country and then also be able to have some type of philanthropy amongst with it. I think it's an incredible opportunity and something that a lot more people should take advantage of.
Mm-hmm. It's free. I mean, they pay for everything. I'm a Peace Corps recruiter part-time at UH.
Oh, wow.
So that's how they do. They have campus recruiters. That's how they recruit a lot of people. But it's not very national where they're talking about it on TV like JFK.
So how do they get you?
So I learned campus about recruiter? It when I was studying in Spain
because
my resident director was a Peace Corps volunteer.
Español.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Gracias.
Yes, in Sevilla. Yeah, I love
from
paella.
Sevilla. Paella.
Yeah, but I've never been to Ibiza.
Ibiza.
But I do love pizza.
Yeah.
So
dumb. Oh,
I'm
good.
Spanish. I'm Spanish. I can do
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I can do it. I can do that. Yeah.
I lived in Spain too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Where was I?
Sorry.
Oh yeah. So I learned about it. Listening to a conversation, looked it up, came back to campus at UH,
mm-hmm.
went to one of those like information sessions, learned about it. I was like, wow, this is so cool.
Yeah.
And then I worked with a Peace Corps recruiter. And now I am a Peace Corps recruiter, so it kind of came full circle. But it's funny because I think I've told this story before. I ended up in Madagascar, not by accident, but it was meant to be. It was like a blessing in disguise because well, when you apply before, they'll send you anywhere. Yeah. But now in the last couple of years, you have preferences. So you could do wherever you want to go in the sector and everything. Yeah. I did any sector and I did Costa Rica, Peru, and Madagascar.
Wow.
And I didn't even want to go to Madagascar. I was because I came from studying in Spain, Argentina, got my certificate in Spanish.
Wow.
And then so I was so set on going to a Spanish speaking country so I can become fluent.
Got it.
So on the application, I was like, oh yeah, Costa Rica would be so cool. I mean, you could go ziplining there, or whatever. Yeah, That's what I was thinking. I didn't think of anything else. And then Peru, I was like, oh, Machu Picchu.
Yeah.
So super cool. But those, I didn't know were the most competitive places. Mm. So I don't know if Ale told you that.
No.
You basically have to be like fluent in Spanish and have like certain skill sets. But I was just trying to finish my application and I was on the M section and I saw Madagascar and I was like, oh, cool, like the movie.
Yeah.
And that's the only reason.
King Julian.
Yeah, that's the only reason I chose it. I knew nothing about it.
Lemurs and King Julian. Yeah, I'm in.
So I ended up getting an interview for that and seeing the interviewer told me about the similarities between Hawaii and Madagascar. Ended up going there, loving it, extended for a year, ended up being there for 3 years. So that's how I ended up
in
Madagascar. It was not even on my radar.
That's so cool though. It's like one of those things that just like, it just happens.
And it changed my life.
It changes your life.
It's, when I talk about the most transformative time of my life, it's always the Peace Corps. Mm-hmm. It's when I learned the most, not about the world necessarily, but about myself.
So for me, that was LA.
Exactly. That was your own Peace Corps.
Exactly.
And everybody has a time in their life where it's like that pivotal moment. It's like the catalyst of change that everybody needs to have. And maybe if you don't know what we're talking about, maybe it hasn't come yet.
Yeah.
But everybody at some point, that one thing that just defines the rest of your life.
And then, and like you said, you weren't searching it.
Exactly.
And that's the beauty of it.
Yes.
It comes at times where you least expect it.
Exactly. Because life gives you what you need.
Not what you are.
Exactly.
Oh, same. Full circle.
Yeah.
Are you good at your job? Yeah, you.
Yeah, I practiced that.
Yeah.
I practiced this exact conversation 20 times in the mirror last night. But yeah, that's amazing. And I hope I can meet your girlfriend one day. And I'm sure, we'll be chatting, about the Peace Corps.
Oh, guarantee. Yeah, she'll rap Spanish with you.
Okay, I need to practice.
You gotta practice.
Yeah, tengo que practicar.
Yeah.
All right, so I like to ask my guests when they come here, what is the meaning of Keep It Aloha to them?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the name of the show.
Yeah.
Merch right over here. If anybody wants to check it out, keepitaloha.com.
Pick
it up. I want to know in your life, how do you keep it aloha?
It's keeping the love in your heart. I think when you're driving in traffic, when you're in a line that's around the corner and down, or when you're at times, it's a reminder, right? Because we all go through day-to-day stuff and we all go through our high points and our low points, but there's no excuse when you're going through a low point to not have aloha in your heart. And I think it's a good reminder for everyone, because we live in a crazy time where not only through social media, through our news sources and everything that we're intaking through a screen, it's most of the time not positive. Most of the time it's actually pretty ugly and not encouraging. And all I want to do is encourage people. I mean, I just want to see people be happy and doing the things that they love to do and that are truly passionate in what they're doing. And like what we had talked about earlier is doing, following your heart and letting everything else follow. And I think by keeping it aloha, you're keeping the pono to yourself, like in your own heart. You're doing what you're meant to be doing. And for me, it's throwing a shaka and smile, you know, simple things. I mean, everyone on tour will tell you that I'm the only one on the water that shakas and smiles everyone as they go by. Most of the time they just look at me like I'm crazy. Yeah. They're like, oh, there's that Hawaiian kid. And I'm just, whether or not, because for me, I know that I could have changed their day.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the time it does. And I have people that come up to me after a whole season. They're like, bro, you know what? I know we don't talk that often, but the one thing I like, you're always smiling and you're always throwing that little signal thing.
That little gang sign.
Yeah, you know, your gang sign. And I'm like, oh, well, that cool, bro. And then that sparks a conversation. Yeah. And then that starts something that, you know, a relationship that would have not started.
Yeah, I love that. I think that goes to show too, is that you don't always have to tell people what aloha is. You can just live it and people will get it.
Yeah.
You know, you can just show them by your actions.
Yeah.
The actions of aloha. You don't have to show, exactly. Aloha, fish,
sleep, repeat.
Repeat. Nice. Oh, nice, yeah. Nice. Aloha, so, fish, sleep, repeat.
Yeah.
That's good.
I mean, I try to live by it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And we
all think you're doing a great job.
Oh, thank you, bro. Yeah. I think we always need reminders.
For sure. Where can we get that merch?
Yeah. Well, one of the companies that I work with called Lateral Vision, they're such a cool company. The way that they're supporting me is they've helped me with a lot of my merchandise. So if you go on to lateralvisionbrand.com, there's a Matty Wong capsule, and you can go down and 100% of those profits of from my capsule goes to supporting me while I'm on the road. So I got some. Get some hoodies, get some t-shirts.
Yeah,
got a couple shirts for you.
Yeah, mahalo. We were gonna do a little jersey swap after.
Jersey swap.
Yeah. Cause I know you said when we were talking the other day that you're kind of just a nomad. You're just living that tour life.
Yeah, like I said earlier, man, like there's a lot of sacrifices that I've had to do to make this a reality. I don't live anywhere. I live everywhere and I live nowhere.
Yeah.
You know? Like I literally, home is where I rest my head right now. And so that's the most challenging part is I think the first time in my life, this is the most I've ever been alone, but I don't feel alone because I feel like a whole person.
That's a great point.
You know,
yes.
When I was younger, I'd struggle with being alone. I always had to be with friends. I always had to, because I was still trying to develop like who I was, you know, until this point where I'm driving 35 to 40,000 miles a year. And a lot of it is just El Solo, you know? And so it's a lot. But it also gives me opportunities to pick up the phone and call friends that I haven't talked to in a long time. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting. And people are like, oh, you listen to music, podcasts? I'm like, yeah, I listen to some podcasts. But a lot of times I'll just drive in silence.
Mm-hmm.
Just reflect.
Nice. Yeah, I do that sometimes too.
Oh, it's because it's too easy to get distracted with all these other things. And you really don't have that many time, that much time throughout a day where you can actually reflect on what's going on.
It's too many distractions.
Yeah.
That's why I learned the most about myself when I lived in the middle of nowhere with no technology in the Peace Corps, because I had so much time to reflect.
You're like talking to lemurs and
stuff. Yeah, exactly. Literally the kind where you see somebody bored throwing a ball against the wall or something.
Yeah.
Done that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But,
awesome.
I love what you said about like the not feeling alone, because I think I wrote about it in my book, or I just thought about it or just talked about it.
Mm-hmm.
Is one thing that I learned when I was living alone is that people would ask like, oh, aren't you so lonely? You're so isolated.
Mm-hmm.
You have no one to talk to. But like, just because you're alone doesn't mean you're lonely.
Yeah.
There's people around you. There's support systems. There's people that you can message or call, or there's your neighbors, your community. So it doesn't have to be like a friend there all the time or somebody in your physical space all the time. Because you could be around a crowd of lots of people and still feel lonely.
Still feel lonely. 100%. You know? Yeah.
So I think the loneliness and I've been thinking about a lot of this recently too, because I talked about it in our 100th episode. Me and my girlfriend broke up a couple months ago because I realized I didn't want kids. So it's like an open thing that I talk about.
That you
now.
Don't?
I don't want kids.
You don't want kids?
Yeah. So
you're selfish for the rest of your life.
Is it selfish not leaving more carbon footprint on the earth?
No. I respect. Trust me. It's something that people are like, oh, how come you don't get kids already? And I'm like, well
we're men. We could change our minds.
We could change our minds.
We could have kids.
No, that's something that, and that's a hard decision. And that's a hard thing a realization to come to, and then to make that choice. So, you know, hey, bro, and power to you, because a lot of people will cave and not be really true to themselves or what they really want.
Just to stay in a comfortable relationship.
just because we're creatures of comfort. Yeah. And as soon as we get bumped either way, we're like, oh, no. Okay, fine. I'll do that thing that I really don't want to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't want to do it, but I know I had to.
Yeah.
But so I've been living alone for the last couple months. And what's crazy about like loneliness is, so I lived alone in Madagascar. So I thought, I'll be easy. Be easy to just live alone. You know, I've done it before. But I'm learning that it's totally different. Well, one, I'm at a different point of my life.
Yeah.
I just came from living with somebody for the last year. And I think here we have so many other distractions. So like living alone there, I'd have to find ways to keep myself busy playing darts or
ball on the
like
wall.
Watching TV, ball on the wall, whatever. Mm-hmm. And now it's like, you can easily just go like on social media or whatever, just look at what everybody else is doing. And you're like, oh man.
You don't feel a part of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or it's like FOMO.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And but when you don't have access to that, like you don't really get
just
FOMO.
Like,
I'm not thinking I wonder what my friends are doing right now as I'm bouncing this wall, ball on the wall.
Yeah.
But one quote that I saw that I loved was, when there's no one to wake you up in the morning, mm-hmm. there's no one to wait, let me try to say it again. When there's no one to wake you up in the morning, there's no one waiting for you to come to bed, when you can do whatever you want, is that loneliness or is it freedom?
Freedom.
Yeah, see?
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah.
That's and I think until you find someone that you can still facilitate both of those places, you know, where you're not compromising either or is not compromising too much. Mm-hmm. I think that's a beautiful place too to arrive at.
Yeah.
That's hard.
And when you're whole, because this is what I'm tying it back to when you said you were whole.
Yeah.
So that's why at different points of your life when you don't feel whole with yourself, you're always looking for someone else to complete that.
100%.
And that's where that feeling of loneliness comes.
I think a lot of times people will try to find comfort in other people, mm-hmm. right? Is like a crutch, right? Or is like a band-aid versus taking that time to really do the heavy work. And that heavy work is within.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the stuff that like people get freaked out about.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, bro. Oh. They look inside. They're like, oh, I don't want
to
look in that
box. People can't stand to be alone with themselves.
It's
because
hard.
They find stuff out about themselves that they don't like.
Everyone. The people that have reached that point in their life and that have gone through that and then been able to turn the page or be able to open the door and step out of it as a new individual are the ones that can actually look back on that lesson and appreciate it.
Mm-hmm.
Because that is the hardest thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Probably for me, my ego, right? I needed to crush it. I needed that needed to be humbled.
Mm-hmm.
I needed to be humbled. And until Los Angeles happened and everything there, probably that was the best thing that could have happened to me.
Yeah.
I didn't like that about myself. I didn't realize it. I'd realize it now. And just trying to find a perfect balance. But that's some wise words.
Yeah. And I'm still learning.
From 2011 grad?
Wise yeah, words. 2011. Yeah. 30 years old.
Junior uncle.
Yeah.
In the making.
Yeah. 30 and thriving.
Third floor, bro. It's a beautiful place.
Yeah. No,
it just keeps getting better.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's cool to be at this point of my career. It's just a new chapter.
Mm.
New chapter. And like that's how I'm looking at it. It's just
that's great though.
Different adjustment period. That's what I keep saying. It's just an adjustment.
Yeah.
But there's so many good things in life. It's hard to, you know, be sad or whatever. And like there's so many people out there, especially with like a social media community, especially with mine that I've built over the last couple of years, so supportive. I just posted something about my community in Madagascar needed $200 for chairs and tables. We raised $1,600 in less than 24 hours.
Bro, that's amazing.
That's just crazy.
But what you're able to to bring that to people that are in need and to be able to give the gift back is like, again, we were talking about it earlier. It was like the best feeling is being able to give, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
That's
100%.
Bro.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Nice. Speaking about giving, what do you hope to give / leave in this world? You know, like what is the legacy that you're trying to leave?
Oh, that's a heavy question. It's a good question.
Yeah. Not heavy like the guy putting in weights in the bass, right?
I heard about that. That was walleye, but yeah that was
he got caught, right?
Then he got caught for like poaching deer.
Yeah.
But that guy's just like a straight up criminal. Yeah. But don't be that guy. Yeah, that's all I want to be. Not that guy.
Yes. The legacy is not that guy.
Not that guy. But no, I mean, it's funny because I look back on some of the influential people in my life. Right. And even people that I've never even met before, like Mike Sakamoto. Like my dad was friends with him, used to help him with travel. Because my dad was a travel agent for a little bit. And he had a friendship with Mike Sakamoto. And I've always, I would look up to him and just idolize him. I'm like, bro, that's such a cool life. You like, you know, you just do your fishing show. So that's my goal. I want to have a show. Mm-hmm. Like after the tour life, I want to do a fishing show. I want to be able to tell stories and share stories of other people and their experiences, you know, and something similar amongst the lines of how you're able to like bring the community together and then to be able to show what Aloha is to them and the rest of the world. I want to be able to show what fishing is for me and the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. and how it's helped them in their life.
I love that.
And so I just want to keep encouraging people to one, do what they love to do, fish. Be smart about it when it comes to the environment. I want to help conservation and that kind of stuff, but just be a good person.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. I don't have this long checklist of things that I need to do or whatever, but what we were talking about earlier is chapters, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to be a pro bass fisherman for the rest of my life. Bro, the tour is exhausting and it's physically and mentally draining. My back's starting to get sore.
Uncle problems.
Yeah, uncle problems. Yeah. Bump out, you learn,
yeah,
boys.
Yeah. Oh, I know that. I saw the funniest thing. Wait, I think I have it saved. I'm going to look for it.
Oh my gosh.
Because I know I have it saved. It's like something about like you're getting old and your back hurting or something.
Bro, I feel that.
I'm gonna find it. It's so funny.
No, but it's crazy. I think everyone has these chapters and you're never defined. Like people always like to define you for, you know, what you're doing or it's as long as you're doing what you feel like you should be doing in that moment and what feels right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Yeah.
You're where you need to be.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, follow your nose. If it feels right, then do it.
Then do
it. If it feels wrong, don't do it.
Don't do it.
Pretty simple.
Yeah. Listen to yourself.
Yeah.
Did you find it?
I found it.
Oh gosh.
This one says, I'm a kid at heart and a senior citizen at knees and back.
Oh my gosh. I feel that.
My knees been already sore too. I just came from F45 too.
This guy. Hit training. All gnarly kind.
Yeah.
Call him. Oh bro. Oh sorry. I was drying off. I just got out of my ice bath. I'm like, whoa.
Yeah. Right. Come by if you like.
Bro,
you like
that's something I think I would get my butt kicked, but would be good.
I mean, you seem like you have a strong mental.
Yeah.
And you're able to push yourself, so I'm pretty sure you'll be fine.
I could hang out. I don't know if I could do as many burpees as you can, though.
Don't go late to F45, guys.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That sucked. But, sorry. Anyways, so moving on, what is some career advice that you'd like to give to the young kids trying to come up, in whether that's content creating, fishing,
mm-hmm.
Photography, whatever, any aspect of your life that you want to give advice to, this the keiki.
The keiki, huh?
Yeah.
Be kind.
Hmm.
I think above all else, just be kind to your peers and to yourself. Know that you're not going to just start creating the most epic things right out the bat. Know that your best friends are going to be out there doing the most incredible things. But encouragement and being nice goes a lot further than you think. And just try.
Mm-hmm.
The worst thing you can do is not try and then say, well, yeah, I could have done that. I could have done that. It's like, bro, do it. Try it. If it doesn't work out and it's something you realize in doing it that that's something you don't want to do, then you're Paul. Like, there's no sense in just continuing something that you're not really truly passionate in, but you don't know until you go.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's something that I think is super important for, I think, kids that grew up here. Is don't be afraid to try.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's something as simple as learning another language or traveling to a different country, go. Hawaii will always be here.
Mm-hmm.
I think it makes it even more special when you leave. And I think a lot of people will attest to that. You grow up here and you have this pride and this understanding what Hawaii is, everything. And yeah, and it's great. But then you start getting comfortable, right? And you don't understand what else is out there. And then the more you leave, you realize, there is no other place in this world that is as special as where we grew up.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes me that much more proud and that much happier every time I come home.
Yeah, and just I love that.
Fills up the battery. Just do, recharges it.
And then I quick charger, iPhone quick charger.
Yeah, quick charge.
I love that.
But yeah, I mean, because I think people get afraid, right? Jumping out of their comfort zone. And I think getting out of your comfort zone, doing stuff that you're not used to doing, trying things you're not used to trying, and just being nice and being, you know, I think that's just kind of, that's what I want to.
Awesome. I love that.
Just share with the kids.
Yeah. I know we talk about it all the time on the podcast and I talk about it with everybody. And I just listen to a podcast about getting this, how discomfort helps you grow. And they mentioned about failure. And he said, I think people should fear failing to try rather than trying and failing.
Yeah.
Because that's the thing that holds people back. People aren't afraid to fail. They're afraid to try
and then fail.
It's the repercussions of the failure that people, the judgments that people are afraid of. And that just comes from trying, but.
No, 100%. 100%. Mm-hmm. Right. I try to be an actor. I sucked at it.
Hey, you still got some credits.
Yeah, you can go watch me get arrested on Hawaii Five-0. I still get paid like 50 cents in the mail.
Hey, there you go. That's 50 cents than most of the people sitting on the couch.
Yeah, not trying.
Yeah,
but,
exactly.
But hey, I tried, you know? And it's, but I also learned something in that too. And I also learned working with a lot of celebrities. Mm-hmm. I'm like, bro, a lot of them aren't happy.
Yeah.
A lot of them, like we were talking about earlier, isn't they're lonely. They're trapped, even though they know everyone knows them and they have these groups. It's like a lot of them are pretty trapped, pretty lonely, and it's pretty depressing. Actually, when you kind of get a little closer, you see it, you're like, whoa, it's actually pretty heavy because of this world that they've created for themselves and then around them.
Yeah, and the persona that
they have to uphold. And so it's, I think with trying to be an actor and seeing all that, I was like, nah, bro, I'm good. I know myself. Oh, that's not going to end well.
I just going to go throw my pole.
I'm going to go throw my pole. I'm going to go try Hanapasa, you know, and then feed the people and I'm okay, you know?
Awesome.
So it's,
super cool. Well, one thing I want to do before we wrap up is talk to you about growing up in Hawaii, but not as a Hawaiian, but involved, very involved in the community and cultural things. I mean, fishing at its core.
Yeah.
It's Hawaiian, you know? Yeah. How do you think we survived? We fish. So did you ever get to a point in life where you kind of just felt confused about your role as a person in Hawaii?
Oh, bro, all the time.
People mistake you for something and you almost felt like insecure about it.
Well, the imposter syndrome, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is like on the mainland. So this is the thing they don't understand, right? So if you're from Hawaii, they call you Hawaiian. And I'm like, oh, no, easy there. Like, I'm from Hawaii, yes. I'm not Hawaiian by blood. Do I have a heart of one? I mean, I like to think I do. I'd like to, you know, put forward the best thing, steward of the land, steward of aloha. But yeah, there's always, I mean, growing up being hapa-haole, you know, like I used to get crap for being half haole, you know? Mm-hmm. And then like my Chinese side was like my savior. But my last name Wong, cause you know, versus if it was like some myth. It's like, it's, that was, you know, and so I struggled with that. And then especially when 23andMe, you know, all the I was like, okay, maybe there's like
1%.
You know, like all those guys ride trip, you know? And that's the thing, you know, it's there's people that I've met some people across the nation that have Hawaiian blood in them that have no like understanding of
or
them,
connection. Or real connection
and have zero and hold zero importance to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it it completely flipped my world. Mm-hmm. Flipped my world. I was like, wait, what? Prah, you have no clue how lucky you are. You have no understanding. And I tell these people, I'm like, brah, you get connected. Get connected. It's not too late. Mm-hmm. And I try to encourage people because it's something that you should be proud of. Super proud of. And it's something that, yeah, I wish I had Hawaiian blood. But look, I mean, I have plenty of Hawaiian friends that don't know how to fish. Mm-hmm. That don't know how to free dive. Don't mm-hmm. know how to surf. And it's not because it's like a pissing contest or something. But it's like, look, brah, there's people, doesn't matter their color or what's in their blood, that will still do what's pono, will still do the things that you and your people have always done forever, you know? And I think I'm just grateful to be in the atmosphere of Hawaiians, of incredibly intelligent and academic Hawaiians like yourself, you know, and being able to like really help the younger generation find that importance, to be able to find that there is a community that is like trying to lift them up and be like, brah, learn mm-hmm. Olelo Hawaii, learn all that stuff. I still, even though I'm not Hawaiian, mm-hmm. I still want to learn. Mm-hmm. Ha, there's nothing more would be super solid to be mm-hmm. out in a lineup and just start rapping in Hawaiian.
Yeah.
You know? And I think that that's something that's so cool. Yeah. And I'll be the first to tell anyone if they ask me, are you Hawaiian? I'll be like, not by blood, no. But 100% by birthright.
Mm-hmm. There needs to be a better classification of all these things because we talk about it all the time. And there's old articles about like having Hawaiian nationality and like…
Well, that's the thing, right? Because then that's the argument, mm-hmm. right? King Kalakaua said, right? Anyone who's born under the sovereign nation of Hawaii is considered Hawaiian.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because emancipated, has all the rights, blah, blah, blah.
Because of like Christianity mm-hmm. and other things. Everyone under God, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm like, yeah, I'm Hawaiian.
Yeah, but then it still doesn't feel right saying it, right?
Exactly.
Yes.
And then that's where it's like, prah, okay.
Yeah, because if I had the power, I would bestow so many people the right to be Hawaiian.
You Hawaiian, you Hawaiian.
And then I will take away the heart for some people. Yeah.
Oh, you litter? Bro, you gone.
Yeah. So it's such a weird thing that…
Not strange.
We emphasize so much in Hawaii.
Yeah.
That I'm sure other cultures do it, but not as much. We're very hyper-focused on it.
Yeah.
What I'm realizing is like, man, at the end of the day… I'm not going to like you based on your blood quantum.
Yeah.
I'm not going to think you're a good person based on your blood quantum. So, and if we're being really realistic, we zoom out 100 years from now, I don't know how many.
Yeah.
Most likely it's going to be dwindled down to a very low percentage. At some point it's going to be gone. And that's just the reality. Unless there's a Hawaiian dating app where we only breed with the people at Alahui, you know?
Yeah.
Like… Yeah. How realistic is that?
Yeah.
You know, at the end of the day, you don't choose your partner based off blood quantum.
Yeah.
You don't choose your friends based off blood quantum. Mm-hmm. Maybe you're in an environment where you're around more people of that race mm-hmm. or culture, but at the end of the day, you're going to gravitate to what you just like.
Yeah.
I want to say this to like take pressure off of people because on the opposite side, there's people who are Hawaiian and they're like, oh, I don't do anything Hawaiian. And I've went through that stuff.
Yeah.
I never surf, never hunt, never fish. So it's always my Hawaiian language background that is like you with fishing.
Yeah. Okay.
It's like, that's my,
you can hold tight to that.
Yeah. My golden ticket or like my thing that I can show like, Here's my mahalo rewards cards. I'm local, you know. Here's my Hawaiian background. Yeah. You can't say even though I don't look Hawaiian or I'm not a surfer, you can't say I'm not Hawaiian, you know.
Yeah.
And it's so stupid that we got to talk about these things at the end of the day.
Yeah, that's local culture at all. Though,
it's local culture, but I think the thing that is important is can you be rooted? Can you go back to your roots?
Mm.
And we're not talking about just Hawaiian because, like I said, we emphasize everything because we live in Hawaii. But I'm more Japanese than I'm Hawaiian.
Mm.
I'm more Portuguese than I'm Hawaiian.
Yeah.
You know? And you can't forget those things.
No.
Because there are biological things about our blood that, you know, affects the way we live. The way I feel when I'm in Aloha or I'm in the water, it's something that you can't put your finger on.
It's spiritual rooting.
Yeah. And so there's definitely a physiological thing that happens when you're mm-hmm. put in places of your kupuna.
Yeah.
So I'm interested to explore the other sides of my ethnicities, yeah. Like learning Japanese, going to Japan, yeah. And seeing what's that like, what that is like. Because my middle name is Sonoda, which is supposed to be actually our last name, because Diaz is my dad's stepdad's last name. So he was adopted by Diaz.
Okay.
So we're actually Sonodas.
Oh wow.
So I know there's a strong connection to the Japanese side, and my grandpa's 100% Japanese, but I didn't grow up with him.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious to explore that side of things, and I think other people should as well.
I mean, for me, it's like, because I never had that Hawaiian connection, I was like, okay, well, my local Chinese side is always something that's I've always been super curious in. And learning the stories, like my great-grandfather was the first Asian to be in the Hawaii Stock Exchange.
Wow.
First Chinese. And go back even further, I learned this when my grandmother passed, was great-great-great-grandfather who worked on a plantation on Kauai, worked his way up to like a foreman, and the owner of the plantation, Porgy, I think, gave him a car, and then from the car's alternator, they projected some of the first films that was ever filmed, ever showed in Hawaii.
That's awesome.
Which, like, I'm like, bro, like, that's just such a, it was a story that I needed to hear in a time that was so dark and heavy for me. And so, like, that's the stuff that I'm like, yeah, okay, ni hao, you know, gaola, you know, gao ma, you know, I don't know how to speak Chinese. It would be interesting, but it's more so my local Chinese side that I want to like learn more about, you know, and then that's the stuff, because it's like, yeah, we're not like, being local is a mixture of everything, you know, we eat rice with our plate lunch, you know, we get like, what is like lomi salmon, you know?
That's not Hawaiian. It's a mix of things,
yeah. You know? And so like the plate lunch, the Hawaiian plate lunch is a mix of things. Mm-hmm. And so I think that wherever you can find that connection and that means something to you, learn about it.
Mm-hmm.
And to your point, finding the different roots in your family, and it not only rewarding, but then it's something, a story that you can pass down.
Yeah.
And yeah.
And it's just cool to know where you come from and why you're like this. It's like if people are into astrology, it's like you're looking for answers. You're looking for answers to something that you don't really understand, or you just want to know.
Yeah.
And when you look into your past, you find out things.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can kind of have affirmation or find an excuse like, oh,
that's why.
Like, yeah, exactly. Like, oh, I talk so much. Oh, it's because I'm Portuguese.
Yeah.
But then I rest easy knowing like, it's okay.
That's
I
why.
Didn't talk a lot because I'm Portuguese.
Yeah,
it's fine, you know?
I'll always eat the fish eyeball.
Yeah.
For the Chinese. And I can't help it.
Yeah. So that, I don't know. It's just such an interesting thing.
Yeah.
And we'll be talking about it for many, many episodes. And
for sure.
Maybe in episode 200, we'll finally have like a good answer. Right now, it's just all factual opinions.
It's factual opinions, bro. It's all facts.
Yeah.
Opinionated facts. But it's true, bro. And I think there will come a time where we have a little bit more of an understanding on how to quantify it all. Because it's a loaded question, bro. It's a loaded topic. And it's, yeah. Yeah.
All right, so I want to know, what is something you wish people knew about you that they don't?
Huh. That's really fascinating.
It's one of my favorite questions.
I don't know, bro.
If you can't think of anything, think about something that people misunderstand about you. Or if anything, just something you'd like them to know about you.
I'm really good at ping pong.
Ooh.
No, it was like we were talking earlier, just jack of all trades, bro. I've just always enjoyed being at least average to above average in everything
that I do. That's just like me.
Bro, like if I'm going to start something, I'm going to be at least average, but above average most of the time of whatever I want to get into. And if I can't get there, nah, it sucks. I'm over
Jack
it.
Jack of all trades, master of none.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. That's why it's a saying.
But then there's a way to finish out that phrase too. And I forgot what it was.
Oh, my new one is Jack of all trades, master of none, chucks.
No.
Because I have nunchucks and I love easy nunchucks.
I won't touch that. But yeah, oh man.
Oh, I know there's a saying. The jack of all trades, master of none is like something.
Better than someone of none.
Yeah, yeah. I know what you're
talking about. What I mean? It's like something like that.
Yeah. Talk for 30 seconds. I could Google it.
Okay, I'm going to talk for 30 seconds.
Say whatever. Make impressions or something.
Okay. Good eye, mate. Today on the Keeping It Aloha podcast, we have special guest Kamaka Diaz. He's looking up something on his phone. Oh, that went to British. Sorry, I was trying to keep it Australian.
All right, we got
it. Okay,
he got it.
Whatever. Okay, we're back.
Yeah. The full phrase is Jack of all trades is a master of none, but oftentimes better than a master of one.
Okay.
Of one.
Of one, not of none. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
There it is.
I like that.
Yeah. Okay, this is really random. A thing that I used to do growing up with my mom, my mom being the holy one, she's always pushed me to do things do whatever you love. She was always the champion of really following my heart. And ever since I was a little kid, I was super into birds, mm-hmm. which is random.
Oh, nice.
I study
of birds. I forget what it's called. Anyways.
Aviarian. I don't know. Yeah. I don't think that is the word, but yeah. We had a bunch of different parrots and small hookbills. And so I love birds. I haven't had a bird in many, 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 many years, but it's something that I have a wealth of random knowledge about birds that most people are like, wait, what? Really? I guess that's something just random that people don't know. But yeah, I don't know. I'm trying to think of other stuff, but I can't really think of anything.
I didn't know that you were really good at either impersonating Japanese or speaking it, because I have no idea what you said.
Oh, yeah, that was
so
all real.
I can't say that it was wrong. I can't say it was right.
Yeah, yeah.
But I know it sounded good. And that's
all that matters.
Exactly. When you sound good, nobody's going to question
you. Hey, fake it till you make it, baby.
Exactly. Right on. So do you have a life hack for us before we wrap up?
Okay, life hack. So you know when you eat like cup of noodle,
okay,
right? And you eat all the noodles and it's pow, and you just have just the soup at the bottom, and you're like, well, I don't really just want to drink this. Get two scrambled eggs, beat them up, put them in the bowl, and you can do with this with top ramen too. Put it in the microwave and microwave it for like 2.5 to 3 minutes.
Huh.
And it's the best chawan mushi you've ever had.
Okay, that's really interesting.
So then that way you can eat your ramen or cup noodle, and then you get chawan mushi after.
Okay, nice. I like drinking the rest of the broth.
Yeah.
But because I usually kind of sip on it while I'm eating.
Yeah.
So I feel like there's not enough. But I guess if I'm ever at a point where there's still a bunch, I'm going to try it out.
Try it.
Yeah, that's a good one.
No, but there. All seriousness, I think just encouraging people to do… Mm-hmm. what feels right to them, mm-hmm. and just to try.
Yeah.
And just goes back to the you don't know until you go thing,
mm-hmm.
you know, because until you actually go out there and just try it, just put it out there. Don't worry about polishing it up too much. Mm-hmm. Just start.
I agree 100%. Kako'o. I love that. All right. So I just got my last fast fave five questions. Okay. These are just rapid fire answers.
Okay.
Okay. Favorite TV show? Favorite movie?
Oh.
Favorite book? Favorite podcast? Favorite favorite song?
I'm going to knock this down again. I'm a huge fan of Quentin Tarantino.
Oh, okay. And I have the same birthday films. As that guy.
Oh, really?
March 27. Yeah.
Oh, dang. Okay. We're like a month apart.
Yeah.
February 26.
Nice.
No, like Pulp Fiction. There's the other one, the one that he did with Leo, about the Manson murder.
Oh, yes. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yeah. I think. Yeah, that's not La La Land. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Yeah. That's good. He's just a good filmmaker, mm-hmm. you know? Just
yeah. And it always kind of odd.
Pulp Fiction, mm-hmm. you know, it keeps you on your toes, makes you think about things. Mm-hmm. And then there's also like weird hidden messages until you really dive into it more. It gives you something.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would say that would be like my favorite movie.
Okay. Stuff. Cool. Or director.
Yeah, director.
For whatever. He's director, yeah. Okay. Favorite fishing snack? Like, so you go out there trolling.
Oh.
Touring. Just hanapa'a all day long.
Yeah.
What are you snacking on?
Probably beef jerky.
Mm.
I would say
crispy,
say
that. Chewy. Ooh. What kind?
Chewy. No, okay. But I like traditional. Because mm-hmm. if it's too soft, and then it kind of just tastes, reminds me of dog food. And I'm like, you know?
Because you had dog food.
Because dog food is delicious.
We love dog food.
Teriyaki dog food. Mean. You put them in a bag, shake them up with some lihimoy.
Sprinkle the lihimoy on top.
No, I'd say that. I mean, that's probably that and like a protein shake. Because I actually don't eat that much when I fish. Mm. Anyone that's ever fished with me, just, full focus.
Yeah. Okay. Favorite way to relax? He's like, what is that?
I
haven't been relaxed since 06.
I'm so ADD, bro. I gotta be doing something. I think being in nature, whether it's on a lake or it's in the ocean, mm-hmm. I think it always brings me like a tranquil moment, but it's always interrupted by the drunken monkey, which is our brain, that is just constantly like, okay, what can we do next? Or like, what's this and mm-hmm. this? But when I do find time or where I am able to kind of center myself to fully relax and chill, it's just like the simplest beach days, I would say. When I'm just hanging out with my friends and we could not even be talking and I was just hanging out and just watching the water lap up on the sand.
Awesome. That's a very peaceful image in my head.
Yeah.
Okay. Favorite pump up song?
Oh man. Animal Lee by Incubus.
I don't know if I know that song.
If I heard it, I probably heard it. I don't know. It's funny. Everyone gives me crap because I got like the same 15 songs on my iPod. They're like, bro, you're a musician. You should have like all this music. And I'm like, I don't know. I'm just too lazy to buy like Apple Music or something.
Yeah, stick with what you like.
I just listen to the same stuff. And then there's also some Stevie Wonder.
Oh, okay.
I'm so random when it comes to my music selection. Mm-hmm. So like a pump up song could be like listening to like this straight like jazz standard called The Chicken.
Mm.
Like, why is that dope? It's like just because that saxophone solo in the beginning was super sick. It just got me amped.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I don't have anything in particular.
Okay. Yeah. But and people get pumped up in different ways. I have like a hype one. So my go-to is Eminem Till I Collapse. That's like my...
Oh my gosh.
Getting in the zone.
And you're like when you're walking into F45.
I usually listen to podcasts going there. But like, sometimes I listen to music. Yeah.
Already.
But yeah, that's like more
today
like sports
on
games.
NPR. You're like, okay.
And then my like chill one is Streetlights by Kanye West.
Okay. Yeah. That's my chill one is Childish Gambino.
Oof, I love Childish Gambino.
I think it's called Summer or
Summertime. Da-da. Sunshine? Can you sing it a little bit?
I'm trying to like when you feel it in the streets. Dun, 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 huh. It feels like summer.
Sunshine? Summer? Is it summer?
Is it summer or is it feels like sunshine? I could be wrong.
Okay. Sounds familiar though.
Goes to show how much.
Oh, yeah. We'll go look it up. Somebody go comment.
That one's like that one just reminds me of driving and not just driving. And I think that's something that in Hawaii, like we do laps, right? And
beach cruise.
And versus just driving, being able to just long drive.
Yeah.
And this reminds me of just the warmth of everything.
Okay. Super cool. Yeah. Well, that was the last one. Oh, no, sorry. We got one more. My bad.
Okay.
Favorite travel destination?
Bro, Japan's awesome.
I know. Everybody keeps saying that. I gotta do that.
Bro.
My brother said, if I learn Japanese and I'm fluent in it, like I can hold a conversation, mm-hmm. once I'm at that point, he'll buy me a ticket to Japan. So that's why I'm
Oh, bro, you're not going to be there for the next...
Right.
Bro, I'm studying for 4 years because you're going to have gray hairs, but I tell you.
I'm confident in my learning abilities.
Dude, you're a cunning linguist. I think you get them, bro. You know? I think you get them. Yeah. Japan's special. Bali was cool. I would say Indonesia. But I think with Japan, I think it's just so... just unlike anything you've ever seen before, you know, and on so many different facets, and it makes you think differently. Like it makes you actually like question certain things that are norms, you know?
Yeah.
Good and bad.
Super cool. I can't wait.
Yeah.
Maybe next year I'll try to get there.
Bro, do it.
But that's all we have for today. I just want to say mahalo for coming and talking stories.
No, mahalo you.
We could definitely keep talking stories. We don't want to keep you here all day. I know Jordan's probably got stuff to do as well, as he's on his phone just ignoring us. But yeah, is there anything you want to say before we wrap up? If not, tell them where they can find you.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, first of all, like mahalo so much. Mahalo nui, bro, for having me on. I do a lot of podcasts, but it's very rare where I get to have podcasts where I don't talk about fishing. You know, not talking about a certain technique specific or something that like, how do I break down this or whatever. It's like being able to talk about life. And you ask such good questions, being able to bring forth certain like subtleties about life and how people are able to have their own paths. And I think being individual and being able to talk about it is really special. So thank you for that.
Yeah, mahalo. So. And thank you for reminding me that you're back in Hawai'i.
Oh, yeah.
Because you're actually... So some people ask to be on the podcast. Some people like tell me about certain people.
Yeah.
A couple people told me about you. They're like, oh, you got to get Matty Wong on.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Man. So some people actually... You were a suggestion.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's humbling.
Yeah. So. And I don't take a lot of like requests or whatever. But
well, thank you.
Yeah. And I'm so happy because it was so fun talking with you.
Well, hopefully it's the first of many to come.
Yes. Yeah. You got to take me fishing one day.
Oh, bro, that's going to be fun.
Back. Wait, when do you leave? You leave in a couple weeks?
I leave in a couple weeks.
Okay, so maybe next time you're back.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to Hilo for...
I'm actually going Big Island to go hunt for the first time.
With Brandon Lee?
With Justin.
Justin.
Yeah.
Justin Lee, sorry. Okay. Yeah. Big Island Boy.
Oh, okay, yeah.
That's the one. Yeah. You know Perrin and all them too? Kind of in the same friend group?
They're the same friend. I know his work.
Okay.
I don't think I've ever
met him. He's more ocean.
More Justin's ocean guy. I mean, Justin's incredible.
Yeah.
Hammer of a spear fisherman as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I'm going to go try to... I'm just getting back into archery. That's super exciting.
Oh, that's gonna be fun.
But yeah, no, we'll find regardless, bro. I'm gonna get you on the water. And okay. We're gonna put some fish in the cooler for you.
Okay, cool.
100%.
All right, I'm excited.
Yeah, if you guys want to follow along and the crazy journey, and I try to stay up to date with my Instagram stories, but my Instagram is Matty_Wong, MattyWong. And then also on YouTube, Matty Wong Fishing. And I do a vlog style post. Whether it's just my travels or it's a tournament or I'm back home in Hawaii, just holo. I try to be consistent with that as a way just to, one, exercise my creativity, two, to be able to document. So, because I get short-term memory loss. So. And so if you guys can go ahead and take a look at that, I mean a lot. And then for all the elders that are watching and are on Facebook. There's like the Facebook page because I think half of the people that are into bass fishing are, you know, they're on the Facebooks. Matty Wong Fishing there. But yeah, that's basically it. Also, if you want, again, if you want to help support too, lateralvisionbrand.com, and you can look up the Matty Wong capsule, and that just goes to supporting me while I'm on the road. And and then if you also want to go and help support all the Kauai boys, I think the Instagram is Hawaii High School Bass Fishing or something like that. Or otherwise, just shoot me a DM and I'll show you where you can support them. But yeah, always trying to help support the,
yeah, love that.
The kids growing up. So
that's how. Well, mahalo, Matty, for joining us on the Keep It Aloha podcast. Spread love, be kind to one another, and mahalo for listening to us today. We have new episodes every Thursday, so make sure you follow us and leave a review. I'm your host, Kamaka. Remember to always keep it aloha.
Aloha. Thank you, bro.